بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر والرجز فاهجر ولا تمنن تستكثر ولربك فاصبر فإذا نقر في الناقور فذلك يومئذ يوم عسير على الكافرين غير يسير ذرني ومن خلقت وحيدا وجعلت له مالا ممدودا وبنين شهودا ومهدت له تمهيدا ثم يطمع أن أزيد كلا إنه كان لآياتنا عنيدا سأرهقه صعودا إنه فكر وقدر فقتل كيف قدر ثم قتل كيف قدر ثم نظر ثم عبس وبسر ثم أدبر واستكبر فقال إن هذا إلا سحر يؤثر إن هذا إلا قول البشر سأصليه سقر وما أدراك ما سقر لا تبقي ولا تذر لا تبقي ولا تذر لواحة للبشر عليها 19 وما جعلنا أصحاب النار إلا ملائكة وما جعلنا عدتهم إلا فتنة للذين كفروا ليستيقن الذين أوتوا الكتاب ويزداد الذين آمنوا إيمانا ولا يرتاب الذين أوتوا الكتاب والمؤمنون وليقول الذين في قلوبهم مرض والكافرون ماذا أراد الله بهذا مثلا كذلك يضل الله من يشاء ويهدي من يشاء وما يعلم جنود ربك إلا هو وما يعلم جنود ربك إلا هو وما هي إلا ذكرى للبشر كلا والقمر والليل إذ أدبر والصبح إذا أسفر إنها لإحدى الكبر نذيرا للبشر لمن شاء منكم أن يتقدم أو يتأخر كل نفس بما كسبت رهينة إلا أصحاب اليمين في جنات يتساءلون عن المجرمين ما سلككم في سقر قالوا لم نك من المصلين ولم نك نطعم المسكين وكنا نخوض مع الخائضين وكنا نكذب بيوم الدين حتى أتانا اليقين فما تنفعهم شفاعة الشافعين فما تنفعهم شفاعة الشافعين فما لهم عن التذكرة معرضين كأنهم حمر مستنفرة فروت من قسورة بل يريد كل امرئ منهم أن يؤتى صحفا منشرة كلا بل لا يخافون الآخرة كلا إنه تذكرة فمن شاء ذكره وما يذكرون إلا أن يشاء الله هو أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة.
البشر عليها 19
جزاك الله خير. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. This is the second surah in this series of tafsir, Surah Al-Muddathir. According to most of the Mufassirin and the narrators, this is the second surah revealed after Iqra. In fact, some of the Mufassirin, even there is a report from Ibn Abbas that says that this surah was even the first one before Surah Iqra. So this report from Ibn Abbas made lots of debate and discussions among scholars and Mufassirin, because the hadith about Surah Iqra in Al-Bukhari and Al-Muslim that Iqra was the first revealed. So this is Ibn Abbas narrates from Jabir, and Jabir was saying that the first thing that was revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhal muddathir qum fa'anzir. And then when somebody asked him, but we know from other narrations that it's Surah Iqra that was revealed, he says, I'm telling you what I heard from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying that the first revelation to me came to when he saw, he said, I saw the al-wahi, the one that came to me in Ghar Hira, and he saw that wahi in a very large shape, covering the entire horizon, and he was scared, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he came to Khadija and he asked her to cover her. Al-Muddathir says, Dathiruni Zammiluni. Dathiruni Zammiluni means cover me. It means cover. And so that's the hadith narrated by Jabir. But when the Mufassirin looked at it, it's inside the hadith. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, حين جاءني الوحي الذي كان جاءني في غار حراء. When the wahi came to me, the same one that came to me in Ghar Hira. So they said, even this hadith indicates that there has been something before this surah. So although in the narration it says the first one, but in reality it's the second one. But then the scholars, they tried to make, to get these two narrations together. They said Al-Muddathir is the first surah that talks to the Prophet as a prophet, to designate him as a messenger, because it says قُمْ فَأَنْذَرْ, it asks him to do انذار. And the first one, Iqra, was the surah to introduce him to Allah Azza wa Jal, to Prophet and to Islam. As we said, Iqra بِسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقْ, it's an introduction that your Rabb is Allah Azza wa Jal, it's not anyone from Mecca. But anyway, it's most of the, let's say, the general public of the scholars agree that Surah Al-Muddathir was the second one. There are some other people, other scholars, they talk about Surah Al-Qalam as being the second one, or Al-Muzzammil. So you will find all of these narrations, but the most acceptable reports is that Al-Muddathir was number two. Sayyid Qutb, when he looks at this between Al-Muddathir and Al-Muzzammil, he says, as if both were revealed at the same time, because they carry the same semantics, the same meaning, and the same, almost the same order. So it doesn't make that big of a difference, except that in this surah, Surah Al-Muddathir, just like Surah Iqra, it specifically designates a person. It talks about specific. Like Surah Al-Iqra talks about Abu Jahl. إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى أَرْرَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى أَرْأَيْتَ إِنْ كَذَّبَ وَتَوَلَّى. Talks about a specific person. This one also talks about another one. Talks about Al-Walid. Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, for a different reason. That Abu Jahl was, he vowed to prevent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam from conveying the message in Mecca. This man, he listened to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he listened to the Quran, and he knew that this Quran is something big, something different. It's something can make a difference. If the people listen to it, they will most likely accept it. So he had to say something. He had to say something wrong against the Quran. And the first ayat that we will, that come in, that were covered in the first 30 ayah. This ayah, in fact, this surah is a rather long. It's 56 ayah, although it's very short. But those ayat are very short and decisive, and they are just pounding one after another. So the first 30 ayah, it talks about Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira. Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, who is one of the tyrants of Mecca, is considered as Abu Jahl, one of the strong leaders, and he vowed to stop Islam, and actually he continued to a kafir, and he died a kafir. He was killed in Battle of Badr as well, just like Abu Jahl. So that's the environment in which the surah is revealed. It's the still we are in the first days of Mecca, still the first days of the revelation. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been introduced to Islam or to Allah Azza wa Jal or to this new concept about being there is a God behind this world, and now he is introduced to the message. In this surah he is being given a message. So that's why in the narration it says the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the first incident of Jibreel telling him Iqra and revealing that first few ayat, he was scared. And we mentioned that he, Khadija alayhi salam, took Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to Waraqa bin Nawfal, and Waraqa bin Nawfal, he mentioned that the Prophet, this man is going to be a prophet, and that he will be chased and he will be challenged by the people of Mecca and so on. And we talked about this at length. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam now is not, he does not know exactly what to do with this. He is not sure what is going to happen. He has seen the wahi. He has been read into a few ayat. But what is next? So he is out of his, call it, instability, not knowing what to do, not understanding what's happening. He is covering himself. He is sleeping. He is trying to just stay out of this world. So the wahi now comes back and wakes him up or shakes him, because you know somebody is sleeping and he's covered in his blanket. You just pull him or you shake him. You say, "Ya ayyuhal muddathir." So you are talking to him and giving him this notion or addressing him by the fact that he's taking a cover, that he's taking a hideout, that he's being trying to cover himself from the world, from the rest of the world. "Ya ayyuhal muddathir." And that name eventually was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was of the, one of the names he was called, Al-Muddathir. Although Al-Muddathir is not the pleasant thing to be called, because that was a time when he was taking a hideout, when he was taking a cover. He doesn't want to see anything around him. That's why called Al-Muddathir. And if you put a blanket on you, it doesn't called Al-Muddathir unless you cover entire your body. Your whole body, you just get the blanket, whatever, cover yourself totally, then you are called Al-Muddathir. But nevertheless, it was one of the pleasant names that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to be called with, Al-Muddathir and Al-Muzammil, which means exactly the same thing. So now here comes the message. What is it that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is entitled to do or is required to do? Ya ayyuhal muddathir, qum fa'andir. These two words. In fact, the most of the narrators and the mufassirin, they say the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was designated as a messenger with these two words, qum fa'andir. Stand up and give the warning. And that's what we mentioned in the previous lesson, where he told Khadija after this word came, qum, he said the Al-Wahi, Allah Azza wa Jal ordered me to stand up. So it is not allowed for me to go back to bed. So please roll out my bed. And Khadija says, from that time on, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would only sleep for very, very few hours. And in fact, the Surah Al-Muzammil, which is the next surah after this, talks about it. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ تَقُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِّ اللَّيْلِ. Allah knows what you are doing. In fact, Allah knows now. He's telling us what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was doing. تَقُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِّ اللَّيْلِ. You keep standing almost one third of the night. وَنِصْفَهُ أَوْ نِصْفَهُ. It says أنك تقوم أدنى من ثلثي الليل, two-thirds of the night, ونصفه or half of it. So it's almost half of it or two-thirds of the night, which means most of the night you keep standing. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, now he is no longer in a mode where he allows himself to sleep or take it lightly. مين قم فأنذر, stand up means you be alert, be always on the go, always doing something. It's not allowed anymore to take things lightly. And that's how the da'wah begins. You cannot begin a da'wah by taking only time out of your work. It should be, you will be doing the da'wah entirely and taking time out of your da'wah to do your daily things. It's not the other way around. So the real da'wah, the real thing to start, especially the beginning. Now later on the Muslims, they relaxed. Somehow after Medina or after even the Islamic State was so strong, they took some time. But at the beginning, the issue was you take time out for your life out of your da'wah. It's not the other way around. Today we do it the other way around. You work, you watch TV, you go to games, you sports, and then you take time out to do da'wah. So the da'wah is almost your extra time, that's where you do the da'wah. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it was the other way around. قُمْ فَأَنْذَرْ, you stand up and you do your da'wah work. So that's the first order to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the next one, it says وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. And here going back to what I was talking about in Surah Iqra, the issue of Rabb is very important right from the very beginning. The first ayah, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق. So ربك الذي خلق, your Rabb is the one who creates. And in the same thing, وربك ربك الأكرم, your Rabb is the most honorable. In Surah Al-Muddathir, immediately you have to stand up, you have to make warning, and your Rabb has to be the greatest. ربك فكبر. ربك فكبر, this is not the pronunciation of Allahu Akbar. Now we say Allahu Akbar almost whenever there is something big is happening, something good, something. Say Allahu Akbar, MashaAllah. We keep saying that. That's not what is meant here. What is meant is make sure that your Rabb is greater than anything else. If you will have hardship, your Rabb is greater. If somebody presents you with a tyrant, your Rabb is greater. If somebody presents you with certain compromising dealing negotiations, your Rabb is Akbar, your Rabb is greater. So always have your Rabb greater than anything else. Be alert of this fact. Be alert of the fact that your Rabb is the greatest. Your Rabb is the highest level. Nothing can go beyond that. Anytime you want to face a new issue, new problem, new negotiation, new dealing, remember your Rabb is Akbar. So Allah Azza wa Jal is reminding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam right from the very beginning, your Rabb has to be always put at the highest level, the greatest, the largest, the strongest. وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. So that you cannot go wrong. Just like the first one, رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقْ, رَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمْ. Here he's saying رَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. Pay attention to this emphasis on this issue of Rabb. And remember that the main problem that we always have with other people, Muslims with non-Muslims, Muslims with other Muslims, is the issue of the Rabb. It's not the issue of Allah being a God that you worship. There is always, almost has never been a problem between peoples of the world as God, Allah Azza wa Jal, being an entity, a deity that you worship, you pray to, you fast to, you make hajj to. That's okay. But for that Allah, for that God to be considered the Rabb means the source of legislation, the source of power, the source of rizq, the source of haya, the source of maut. He is the one who provides all life and death, power and dignity and honor and humiliation and mulk and izzah, all of these. Allah Azza wa Jal as a Rabb. That is where the differences are. That's where people sometimes they get, well, they, when it comes to legislation, to authority, to rizq, they look for something else. They look for agencies, they look for powers, for Security Council, for all types of United Nations, and you name it. But when that's why the issue of Rabb is emphasized right from the very beginning. So you cannot underemphasize that. And we keep repeating it time and time so that it always sticks in the minds. And then the ayah goes in, وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ. ثِيَابَك literally means your clothings. But in essence, what does this cleansing or cleaning or tatheer of thiyab would do with the initiation of a message? To start a message in a society like Mecca that has been corrupted, polluted, it has all types of mischief and atrocities. So what does the clothing have to do with that? Although in Mecca what was really polluted or polluting the whole society are the idols. Now in Arabic, as expression, the expression is about the clothing. Somebody, in fact, the old Arab poets used to say that if you want to be clean, clean means in the society, come out with a clean clothes. Clean clothes doesn't mean that your clothes is clean. It means clothes, clean acts, clean work, clean deeds, clean heart. That's the expression is they use the thiab because the clothing is the outward, is what the people see from you. It's the first thing the people see is your clothing. So your clothing are clean means you are clean. But that is an expression, it's not for real. Because your clothes may have something spilled on it. You are working. It doesn't mean that you are not a good person. So ثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ, it means make sure that everything within you is absolutely طاهر. And طاهر is the word clean does not really mean طاهر. See, الطهارة, it means that it is absolutely contains no type of filth, no types of wrongdoing, no types of najasa, no types of corruption. Anything that can degrade the person is called something that requires tahara. So tahara is not only just to take the wudu or to take the cleaning. So the word clean does not really mean tahara. Tahara is just like Allah Azza wa Jal called Ibrahim alayhi salam, says, وَطَا أَن طَهِّرَا بَيْتِيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَعَهِدْنَا إِلَى إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ أَن طَهِّرَا بَيْتِيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْقَائِمِينَ وَالرُّكَّعِ السُّجُودِ. So Allah Azza wa Jal called Ibrahim and Ismail to make tahara for al-bayt al-haram. طَهِّرَا بَيْتِي. At-tathir in this case, it means that make sure it doesn't have anything that associates something with Allah Azza wa Jal, any shirk. So take all forms of shirk, take all forms of corruption, take all times of pollution from the al-bayt al-haram and make it tahir. Tahir for the people to come and make hajj. So that does not mean cleaning. So thiyabaka fatahir does not necessarily mean cleaning. It means make sure that you are pure without any type of mistake, any type of sin, any type of problem, anything that can degrade you. So that is at-tathir, and the word thiyab and the thub, the clothing, it is just an expression which is very commonly used in Arabic literature, especially in poetry. That in fact there is one famous poet whose poetry used to be, poems used to be hanged around the Kaaba called Mu'allaqa. So the Arabs, they had this fancy things about specific poems. There were few of them, they used to hang them on the Kaaba and they called them Mu'allaqat. Mu'allaqa means it's something on the Kaaba. One of those poems which was used to be hanged on the walls of the Kaaba is something that somebody calls a person telling, if you see that my moral is so bad, إِن تَكُ سَاءَتْ مِنِّي خَلِيقَةٌ فَسِلِّي ثِيَابِي مِنْ ثِيَابِكِ تَنْسَلِي. If you think that I have a bad character, then take your clothes away from my clothes so you will be clean. So let your clothes not to be associated with my clothes so you become clean. If I am bad, with moral character, so make sure your clothes does not mix with mine. Now, clothes in this case, character or behavior. So that is just to emphasize, to say that the word thiyabaka, when you read the translation, clean your clothes, does not really give the full meaning of the ayah. Thiyabaka fatahhir means be absolutely pure. So that's the essence of this ayah. And then the next one, it actually explains that وَالرِّجْزَ فَهَجُرْ. A ridz in a nutshell, it's called, is the najasa. Something najas, something ridz, something filthy. And the in this ayah, it was specific for the ibadatul asnam, for the asnam, the idols. And some people in the tafsir, they said, oh, how is it that Allah Azza wa Jal is calling the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam to leave, to stay away from al-rijz, which is the asnam, although the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam never did al-asnam. So it doesn't make sense to ask him to stay away from asnam when he did not do that. But in the, again, in the expressions or in the orders of Allah Azza wa Jal to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to say al-rijz fahjur, you make hajr for al-rijz, not necessarily for him, but for those who follow him. And to indicate that ibadatul asnam or the filth of asnam has to be absolutely absolutely disassociated from. You must be disassociated from al-rijz. And in the Quran, Allah told Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to stay away from things which he doesn't do. Like in Surah Al-Ahzab, Ya ayyuhan nabiyu attaqillah. Says, وَلَا تُطْعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ. Do not obey the kuffar and the munafiqeen. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never obeyed al-kuffar or al-munafiqeen. But Allah Azza wa Jal continued to say, to tell him, do not, never do that. Never do that does not mean you have done that. When I tell you, never ever abide by the rules of kuffar, it doesn't mean that you have abided by it. It means a continuous warning or continuous requirement. So this is a continuous requirement for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, وَالرِّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. So make sure that ibadatul asnam and asnam, the worship of idols, and anything that has to do with the ridz of Mecca. Now, here a few words on al-ridz of Mecca. Remember I mentioned when I was talking at the beginning at Surah Iqra, there were three young men who at one point looked at the practices of Quraysh and the practice of Mecca, the way they do the corruption, the way they do at-tatfif in al-mizan, which means they change the scales of for trade, the way they kill their daughters, the way they worship the idols, the way they go around the Kaaba naked. They used to see all of these practices, and they said, oh, Quraysh cannot be on the right path. So we have to leave al-hajr. Hajr means leave for good. Don't be with them. They had to make hajr for the ridz of Mecca, for the ill practices of Mecca, ill practices of Quraysh. Quraysh had ill practices, and their practices were absolutely absurd in the sense, the way they treat the people who come to hajj, the way they have the idols, the way they treat the slaves or enslave the people, the way they kill their children, the way they have their sexual relations with the women. In Mecca, in Quraysh, they used to have, if somebody is getting married, so he will send his wife to one of the chiefs of Mecca to sleep with him before he does, so that he will give her the blessings. That was typical. They used to have open prostitution. So it was ridz. So when Allah Azza wa Jal tells Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَالرِّجْزَ فَهَجُرْ, means disassociate yourself and leave for good all of these practices, all of these practices of Mecca. Do not accept any of them. Leave them altogether. And in the Surah Al-Muzammil, which we will talk about later, it says, وَهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا وَاصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ وَهْجُرْهُمْ هَجْرًا جَمِيلًا. That be patient and hajr. Make them make hajr from the people of Mecca. Al-hajr al-jamil, hajran jamila, means a beautiful hajr. And the beautiful hajr means you disassociate yourself from them while you are still there. Because sometimes the people, they use the word al-hajr and they take hijrah. Because the hijrah means migration. It means to migrate, means leave. So some people would think, al-rujza fahjur, you will leave the ridz of Mecca and get out of the society. In fact, we have been faced with all of these challenges from people, they will tell us, leave. You don't like the society, leave. You don't like the kufr in it, leave. Get out. Whether it's in the Middle East or in America or all over. Here Allah Azza wa Jal is telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what you should leave is not the place. You should leave al-rijz. Al-rijz is the ill practices. That's what you leave. You don't leave the location. It's not the space departure. You don't leave the space. You don't leave the area. You don't leave the locality. You leave, you make hajr for the practices. In fact, there was a misconception about this hajr in the teachings from Sayyid Qutb in the early 50s and 60s, where there were a group of people, they used to call them at-takfir wal-hijra. So they look at the society, they say the society has lots of rijz and kufr, so they have to make hijra. Hijra means they leave, and so they went out to the mountains and they left the cities. And later on, of course, there were lots of troubles between them and the government. It doesn't mean they had wrong hearts or wrong intentions or ideas, but their explanations, their understanding of the hijr was not the way the ayah is talking about. The ayah is talking about al-rijza fahjur. It does not talk about al-hijr for the persons who make rijz. It's not a hijr for the area, the place where there is a rijz. It's a rijz itself, which is the ill practices, the ill behavior, the wrongdoing, the corruption itself, you leave it. So al-hijra is for corruption, is not for the area or the otherwise, if you leave the place of corruption, then who is going to make the correction? If you leave the place of kufr, then who is going to make the da'wah? If you leave the place where the fusuq is being done, then who is going to correct that? So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying al-rijza fahjur, and it's very accurate statement. It is the hajr for, and the hajr means, as I said, departure, migration, leaving, this association, all of these meanings, you can apply any of these meanings to this word, al-hajr, but it is for al-rijz, for pollution, for kufr, for fusuq, for fujur, for any ill practices, that's what you make al-hajr for. And then comes a notion to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like cautious. وَلَا تَمْنُن تَسْتَكْثِرْ وَلَا تَمْنُن. The word تَمْنُن is from the word man. The brother who was doing the tarawih today, he read the ayat about الَّذِينَ يُتْبِعُونَ الصَّدَقَ بِالْمَنْ, those who follow the sadaqah. وَلَا تُتْبِعُوا صَدَقَاتِكُمْ بِالْمَنْ. Do not follow your sadaqah with the word man. After you give sadaqah to someone, you give charity, do not brag about it. Do not make mention of it. And this is called بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى. Adha means you really hurt the person that you give him. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he is using this word here to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا تَمْنُن. Do not use man. Al-man is to brag about an act that you have done. Is to remind the people of the goodness of your work. So now your work is going to be good. You are going to provide guidance. You are going to give the da'wah. You are going to bring Islam to the people. And this is something absolutely new. This is something absolutely new. You are going to be the caretaker of the society, the giver of the Islam. You are going to bring all of these notions of Allah Azza wa Jal being a Rabb, that Allah Azza wa Jal is al-Alim, Allah Azza wa Jal da'allama bil-qalam, and so on. You will bring it to the people of Mecca and to the rest of the Arabs. But that will probably provoke you, will give you that incentive that, oh, mashallah, I am giving something big. Do not do that. Do not tell the people or give them any impression that you are giving a favor upon them. This is the favor of Allah Azza wa Jal. Tastakthir, that's tamnun. Tastakthir means you need something more. In return, you need the praise. To be praised in return. You do not do that. Your praise is going to be from Allah Azza wa Jal. Another understanding of tastakthir, or this wala tamnun tastakthir, these are two different things. One of them, do not make men, do not make favor or play favor against the people. If you don't do that, you will get more. Allah Azza wa Jal will give you more. which means the quieter you are, the more humble you are on this da'wah, on this Islam, on this deen, on this nubuwa, Allah Azza wa Jal will give you more. So the more you are humble, the more Allah Azza wa Jal will give you. In either way, meaning it all implies that number one is that with this da'wah, never, never, ever think that I am better than the people. Never ever think that I am in a better position. Never ever ask for a return for what you do in the da'wah. It all comes from Allah Azza wa Jal. Never ever give the people impression that, oh, if it was not for me, you would have been ignorant. Oh, if it was not for us giving tafsir, nobody would have known the Quran. If it was not for us doing this explanation about things, people would never have understood the politics of Islam. Or people would have never even understood the things about the Khilafah. We talk about Khilafah a lot. We don't do, never do that. Because this is a favor from Allah Azza wa Jal that He bestowed upon us. So you have no favor whatsoever in this. And even to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah is telling the Prophet, you have no favor to bestow upon the people. It is Allah's favor that He bestowed upon you. In fact, there is an ayah in the Quran that talks about this to the Muslims. It says there was a time when the Muslims, they appeared in a situation as they were making it as their Islam is a favor. They say that, oh, we are giving يَمَنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا. The fact that they have become Muslims, they say, see, we are Muslims. At least we become Muslims. So we are the Muslims. So we are your companions. So that's to show that we are giving you a favor. So the Quran says, يَمَنُّونَ عَلَيْكَ أَنْ أَسْلَمُوا قُلْ لَا تَمَنُّوا عَلَيَّ إِسْلَامَكُمْ. Tell them, do not give me this man. Do not tell me that you have become a Muslim so that you are doing me a favor. بَلِ اللَّهُ يَمَنُّ عَلَيْكُمْ أَنْ هَدَاكُمْ لِلْإِيمَانِ. But Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who can show His favor because He guided you to this iman. So all of it boils down to Allah Azza wa Jal. So never forget that. So that's very important. And look, Allah right from the very beginning, because He knows the psychology of a human. He knows the psychology of His Prophet. He's a man. He's a person. And out after a few ayat or surahs will be revealed, he will say, oh, Allahu Akbar. I have something that nobody has. I have something coming from Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a revelation. It is much more powerful than the poetry in Mecca. It's much more powerful than their idols. It's much more powerful than all their corruptions. And I can bring it and I can challenge the whole world with it. That is big. That is tempting. That is tempting for this self-arrogance, if you will. So right from the very beginning, Allah Azza wa Jal, before even that happens, and it never happened to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, actually the opposite used to happen, but before it happens, before it even comes to his brain, he says, beware of that, don't do it. And that order comes to us, as I mentioned, because, and I know as a fact, sometimes some of us will probably learn something that maybe scholars wouldn't know. Like things about the proof of the existence of Allah Azza wa Jal. There are many, many scholars who wouldn't even dare to go there. And here you'll have brothers who are just starting in this da'wah. They know that very strongly. They can argue about it. They can take any atheist, any communist, and can beat him with these ideas. Man, those are great. You can talk about some usul issues that people, they go to Azhar for years, and they won't understand them. And here you know some things about usul. That is tempting to brag. That is tempting. You have sometimes knowledge about political, economic Islam. There are many, many Muslims. Most of the Muslims, they wouldn't understand that. They wouldn't understand the rules about riba, about bay'a, about ijara, about wakala, about... And here you know, and you study them, and you read them, and you find yourself in a place where, oh, you know better than people who have gone to Sharia schools. And you are confident with that. But that confidence sometimes gives the impression for the people, maybe not for you, that you are bragging, that you are playing a favor. Here, right from the very beginning, it says, don't do that. Don't do that. Make sure you don't do it. Even if the people are not saying it, but you for yourself, make sure you always watch that. ولا تمنن تستكثر to be praised, to be told, oh mashallah, you know a lot, or two, or at least so you can be able to get more knowledge. Because the moment you start bragging about your knowledge, you'll stop gaining more. The moment you start thinking that I know a lot and I can give a lot, then you'll stop learning. Because you think you already, you are superior to the others, and so you wouldn't even get more. But once you get in the mood, no man wala tamnun, and that goes for sadaqat also. For the sadaqah, when it says وَلَا تُتْبِعُوا صَدَقَاتُكُمْ بِالْمَنِّ وَالْأَذَى, a person who gives a sadaqah for Allah Azza wa Jal and does not follow the sadaqah with the man, saying that I gave something, will always be willing to give. Always be willing to give, because he never expects a return for that, except from Allah Azza wa Jal. But the ones who give the sadaqah and wait for people to say, oh, you gave something, and if they say that you gave, خلاص, I got my reward. I got it. So I'm known to be the giver. So you no longer give. People have the notion that, oh, you give sadaqat, you give things, most likely you will stop. Because the title has been assigned. So Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't want that to happen. And then comes, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. So we'll stop in about 5 minutes, inshallah. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. All of these are orders to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Remember, قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. Stand and warn. رَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. Make sure that your Rabb is always greater. ثِيَابَكَ فَطَهَّرْ. Make sure that your behavior, your practice is always pure. الرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ. Make sure you depart and you disassociate yourself from all rids. وَلَا تَمْنُنْ تَسْتَكْثِرْ. And never do a man. And you will get plenty. And then the last one, لِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. You make your sabr for Allah Azza wa Jal. And that's a very interesting notion. And again here, the word رب comes back. And it's still emphasis on the word رب rather than إله. Although إله is very important, it's almost the synonym of رب. But the emphasis on رب, because that was the issue of Mecca. لربك فصبر. الصبر, you have to face challenges. The meaning here, you are going to face challenges in the society of Mecca. In this da'wah, you will get all types of challenges. So you require صبر. But the صبر is for Allah. You do the sabr for Rabb. You don't do the sabr for anything else. You don't do the sabr for the fact that you will get victory, or for the fact that you will get a reward, or for the fact that you will get a comfort. All of this will come as side effects. But the sabr, you do it for Rabb. The sabr, you do it for Rabb. In Surah Al-Muzammil, Al-Muzammil, he says, فَصْبِرْ عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ. Here he doesn't say, فَصْبِرْ for what? There he says, فَصْبِرْ, make sabr for what they say, for their saying, for their problems, for their challenges. عَلَى مَا يَقُولُونَ, they will say a lot of things. They will say you are a poet, they will say you are a magician, they will say you are insane, they will say you are a fitna, you are a troublemaker. They will say all types of things, you have to make sabr. Sabr means tolerance. Tolerate that. Take it, absorb it. Because sabr means absorb. Absorb this. Take it. Do not show your furiousness. Do not be furious. Do not lose your calm. Do not lose your patience. Do not lose your ability to provide. That's what a sabr means here. But in this ayah, in Surah Al-Muddathir, he doesn't say, what is it that requires sabr? He says, to whom you make sabr. So the sabr here is very general. So telling the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now, the Prophet has not faced anything yet. This is the first stuff. اقرأ, and then يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر. He still hasn't done anything. Jibreel is coming to him and telling him those six orders. Six orders being part of his nubuwah, part of his prophethood. Still he has not faced any challenges. Nobody has told him anything. Not yet. That's why in general it says وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. And remember what Warqa bin Nawfal told him, told the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if I were still alive and strong at the time when your nation is going to evict you out of Mecca, I will give you the victory, I will give you the support. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, are they going to do that to me? He told them, of course, this has happened for all the prophets before you. So it will happen to you. So that's what Warqa told them. Now this is what Jibreel is telling him. This is what Allah Azza wa Jal is saying through Jibreel. The wahi comes in, says, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. So something has got to happen. This da'wah is not going to be light. And in Surah Al-Muzzammil, he told them, سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ إِنَّا سَنُلْقِي عَلَيْكَ قَوْلًا ثَقِيلًا. It is going to be heavy on you. It's going to be a heavy word, heavy stuff, heavy message. It's not going to be light. Here he doesn't talk about the message, how strong it will be, or how challenging it's going to be, but he's giving him the after. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. So there has going to be a requirement for sabr, but remember, you have to make the sabr for Allah Azza wa Jal. If you do it for the sake of Allah, for the sake of Rabb, then you can go through. Because a sabr, it has limits. There is a threshold for how much you can tolerate. There is a threshold like Sayyidina Ayyub alayhi salam. There is a threshold for the sabr. That's when we say sabr Ayyub. Allahumma give me the sabr of Ayyub. He had lots of patience, but then he has a threshold. There is a threshold, there is a limit. Now, that limit, if the sabr is for Allah Azza wa Jal, then the limit is almost unbounded. There is no limit. Because it's for Allah Azza wa Jal and Allah is always there. But if the sabr is associated with anything else, there is always a limit. If I'm making a sabr until the victory comes, the victory may not come. If I make a sabr until my life becomes better, my life may never come better. If I make sabr for my children to grow up, maybe my children never grow up and they get killed or they die. So if the sabr is associated with anything else but Allah Azza wa Jal, then there is always a threshold. There is that much which you can do sabr for, beyond which you cannot. And that is in fact when there are wars and there are challenges and there are struggles, that's what the enemies usually they play on. They say, what is the limit of your sabr in a war, in a fight? And they play on that limit. And they want to push you to the limit of your sabr, so beyond that you can surrender. And in fact, in what's happening in Syria today, the armies and the...
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulihi al-kareem. والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. We'll continue inshallah tonight in this program, the series of programs of the Qiyam. We'll continue the tafsir of Surah Al-Muddathir, which we started last time. Last time that this surah, Al-Muddathir, is most likely based on most of the narrations. It was the second surah revealed after Surah Iqra. Surah Iqra was revealed as the starting of the Nubuwa, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was designated as a prophet. And Surah Al-Muddathir, again according to Mufassirin and narrators, this is the surah which Allah Azza wa Jal designated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to start the mission. So the first one is to introduce Prophet, peace be upon him, to the prophethood. اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق. And this one, قم فأنذر. Stand and do the warning and convey the message of Islam. And we mentioned that this beginning of the surah talks about the calling on Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to accept the message from Allah and to begin this whole mission. قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ. And in this process, that Allah Azza wa Jal, his Rabb, shall be the greatest, and he has always to make sure that Allah Azza wa Jal is at the highest level of any event. And وثيابك فطهر. Make sure that everything is pure, everything is clean. You have no worries whatsoever. والرجز فهجر. This is just a reminder. Leave all types of idol worshipping, all types of filth, pollution, any of the customs and the traditions that Mecca had been used to. And we also mentioned that when Allah Azza wa Jal says والرجز فهجر, leave الرجز, which is the filth, does not mean that he has been doing it. So the order of Allah Azza wa Jal to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to leave a certain behavior does not mean that he has been indulged in this behavior. So that's just to understand the context of the word fahjur. And then ولا تمنن تستكثر, do not try to brag about what you are doing. Let's say from the very beginning, be humble, just do your mission, and this is from Allah Azza wa Jal. And in the course of da'wah, you will face all types of things that require sabr. وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. So that's where we finished last time. Now, the next set of ayat, there is a buffer, there is a gap between the first group of ayat and the next one. So here is the next group of ayat talks about Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira. It talks about someone who is trying to block the path of da'wah, to block the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But before getting into that, Allah Azza wa Jal introduces the concept of Day of Judgment for the first time. Now remember, this is just the beginning of the revelation. All we have from the Quran is the first few ayat from Iqra and these ayat from Surah Al-Muddathir. Then Allah says, فَإِذَا نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ فَذَلِكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوْمٌ عَسِيرٌ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ غَيْرُ يَسِيرٌ. Just like that, out of a sudden, at the beginning he's talking to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِرُ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. Or you who has taken cover, or who has covered himself in a blanket, stand up and go and warn, and do the warning. And then until he says, وَلِرَبِّكَ فَصْبِرْ. Be patient, be tolerant. And then out of a sudden, without any introduction, Allah is talking about the Day of Judgment. فَإِذَا نُقِرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ. When the day, and النَّاقُور is another name for الصور. Like وَنُفِخَ فِي الصور. نَفْخَةٌ وَاحِدَةٌ. When the angels will blow into the big horn to blow and declare the start of the Day of Judgment. That's the declaration of the end of the current life and the beginning of the next life. فَإِذَا نُقْرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ. So here's Allah Azza wa Jal is putting this pretext, something new. There is النَّاقُور is going to be, it's like the big bell that will be rung. It's a big horn that will be blown. Something is going to happen. But that day is a day which is going to be difficult for the kuffar. عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ غَيْرُ يَسِيرٌ. فَإِذَا نُقْرَ فِي النَّاقُورِ فَذَلِكَ يَوْمَئِذٍ يَوْمٌ عَسِيرٌ. That's a very difficult day, and it will not be easy on the kuffar. So what is the relevance of this? Well, the relevance of this comes with the next ayat. So here Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this introduction about the Day of Judgment. A day is going to happen, but that day will be very difficult for the kuffar. It's not easy day. It's very difficult. Seriously, it is difficult and rough and harsh for the kuffar. عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ غَيْرُ يَسِيرٌ. Upon the kuffar, it's not going to be easy. So here is just the talk about that day. And as I said, the relevance of that day comes immediately after. Why? Well, here Allah Azza wa Jal is in the next ayah says, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. And that's the catch. The catch is a person, and the story is goes like that. In Mecca, the elites were, as I mentioned earlier, Abu Jahl, who was the target of the Surah Iqra. We talked about Surah Iqra. He was the target. Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, he is the target in this Surah. And there are other people like Al-Akhnas bin Shuraiq and Ibn Abi Ma'it and Abu Sufyan at the time. He was still a kafir. Those were the big elites, and Abu Lahab, of course. And Abu Lahab, he was targeted in a whole surah by himself, Surah Al-Masad, Tabbat Yada Abi Lahab and Watab. So those people, they took it on their shoulders. They took it upon themselves to block the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to block the path of al-khayr, to stop this whole khayr, this whole deen, this whole revelation, to stop it. They thought that it is upon them, it's they have to do something so that this message of Islam does not get any farther. And Al-Walid bin al-Mughira, it is reported that he listened to the Quran, which was just revealed, like, so, اقرأ بسم ربك الذي خلق, maybe the first ayat, أيها المدثر قم فأنذر, just few ayat, he listened from Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr had already been a Muslim. Now, Al-Walid came out from the house of Abu Bakr, and somebody asked him, what do you think of this Quran, of what you have here? He said, well, I have some my own thoughts about it. So some people told him, it looks like he's a kahin. Kahin means like a priest. He says, no, no, no. You know that priesthood doesn't sound like that. Somebody said, he could be a poet. He said, no, that's not what I've heard. What I've heard is not poetry at all. And somebody said, he's a magician, sahir. And he said, no, that's not true, because we've heard, we know a sahara. We know how the sahara, they make their, all their talks and tricks and dealings. That's not, that doesn't sound like a sahir. Then they asked him, what is it? Al-Walid, he said, Muhammad claims it is the words of Allah. It must be that. So Al-Walid says, it must be that. Because what I've heard is something that cannot be matched. إنه لا يعلو ولا يعلى عليه. It is something that is that goes at the highest level. Cannot, nothing can be higher than that. وإن له لحلاوة. It is so sweet. وإن عليه لطلاوة. It is like it's always with it's wet with dew, just like in the morning with some rain, with some water. It's clean. It's nice. إنه لمثمر أعلى. It is fruitful from above, just like a fruit. مُغْدِقٌ أَسْفَلُ. From beneath, from the bottom, it is so rich. It's nothing like the word of people. لَيْسَ كَقَوْلِ الْبَشَرِ. So when Abu Jahl and the other people, they heard him saying that, they said, Al-Walid, if you continue to mention these words, the whole people of Arabia, or at least Quraysh, when they listen to you saying that, they will follow Muhammad. They will follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so you cannot say that. So you have to say something else. So now, Al-Walid, he says, let me think. He says, let me think about it. And he starts thinking, and he continues to think, and he comes with a solution. And the solution, he says, yeah, he is not a sahir, but he is sahirul bayan. Sahirul bayan means his, like, charismatic. It's the word charisma with the words. His words are have this magic touch because they influence the people, and people will not be able to hold themselves straight or steady because his words. And that's in Arabic they call sihr al-bayan, means the words and the literature and the writing and the style is absolutely superb. So it's only the words, and that's what we are going to say. So let's say he's sahir. And Allah Azza wa Jal is depicting that situation very well here. When he talks in the next few ayat, إِنَّهُ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ. He thought, and then after he thought about what he has heard, then he made taqdeer. He has two things, فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ. He thought, he arrived at conclusion. وَقَدَّر means he made an estimate. He made some, okay, yeah, I arrived at the conclusion that these words cannot be the word of Muhammad. But what am I going to say? I have to say something else. فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرْ فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرْ. He's قُتِل. It's a dua from Allah Azza wa Jal, or it's a determination that this Walid, he will be killed. He will kill on the basis of how he made taqdeer. كيف قدر. Not كيف فكر. كيف قدر. The way he made taqdeer. ثم قتل كيف قدر. Then he is going to be killed or he will be damned or condemned the way he made this estimation. So here is the point that the Quran is giving us the view or the picture of this person is walking, talking, thinking, but then at the end of the day, instead of concluding whatever he has thought, you know, his thought had led him, his thinking led him to a conclusion, but he doesn't want to admit that conclusion. That's a denial. So the Quran is condemning him based on how he made this taqdeer instead of tafkir. So let's go through the ayat now, the way Allah Azza wa Jal brings this whole scenario, right from the very beginning, before he even mentions how Al-Walid bin Mughira, what he did, he says, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. ذَرْنِي. ذَرْنِي, the word ذَرْنِي means, let me deal with this person. Let me deal with him. And this word ذَرْنِي is repeated in Surah Al-Muzzammil. When we talk about Al-Muzzammil, he uses the same thing, ذرني والمكذبين. Says ذرني means let me deal with, leave them to me. You know, sometimes someone is approaching you, he wants to fight, he wants to do, he's an aggressive. Then comes a big guy or someone who is really powerful. He says, I will handle him. Don't worry, I will handle this guy. So here is Allah Azza wa Jal right from the very beginning, is telling Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you may not be able to handle Al-Walid or Abu Jahl for that matter or those big elites. I will handle them. Let me deal with them. Let me take care of that. And that is a big comfort. Now remember, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still starting new. This is a new da'wah. It's a new Islam. He has not been there for a long time. And right from the very beginning, the big elites, the big powerful elements in the society are opposing him. So he needs the big support. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he starts immediately telling him, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتْ. Let me deal with this person, the one I have created with my own hand. I created him alone, single. Now, وَحِيدَ, it implies two things. I created him all by myself, or I created him a single person. But the next ayah doesn't show he is single or he is one, because he talks about his children. So the most likely the word wahida, it refers to Allah Azza wa Jal, reminding of the power of Allah. ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. I created him alone by myself without any help. I created this person and I can deal with him and I will deal with him. Let me handle that. And that is for the da'wah, for someone who is starting a da'wah, for an oppressed person, for a small group, just like in our days. When you are carrying the da'wah and you look in front of you, there are big, big, powerful entities. They are superpowers. They are ones who are way beyond your ability. And then you get this impression that Allah Azza wa Jal is stepping in to deal with that. I will handle that. I will handle those powerful elements. I can handle this tyrant. I can handle that one. Alone I can handle him. To me that will be big comfort. To me as a person who is carrying the da'wah, I will immediately in my head, in my brain, in my emotions, Allah Azza wa Jal is behind my back. He is stepping in. He will handle those big elites that are beyond my power. So that is a very powerful ayah right from the very beginning. ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا. Let me deal with this entity. And I can deal with him alone. And after all, Allah Azza wa Jal says, I am the one who gave him the money. وَجَعَلْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا. I am the one who gave him the power of money or the wealth. مَالًا مَمْدُودًا. مَمْدُود means extended wealth. A wealth that goes beyond his ability even to handle. It's way extended. It is too much wealth. I gave it to him. ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا وَجَعَلْتُ لَهُ مَالًا مَمْدُودًا. I gave him money which is extended. مَمْدُود, extended means it goes on and on and on. He has lots of wealth. And also I gave him banin, وبنين شهودة. Now, وبنين شهودة, I gave him children. In some of the narration, they say he has 13 children, 13 sons or 10 sons. But he has many. He has many. One of them was Khalid bin al-Walid. And another, some of his sons were killed in Badr as well. And the word شهودة, in the tafsir, they say شهود, his wealth was so huge and he had so many servants that his children did not even have to go and let's say to Sham, to Yemen for trade, for caravans and for commerce. They were always around him. That is a sign of power, just to show that this person was, he was always feeling his own power, his own strength, because his banin, his children, his sons were all around him. They were witnessing his power. But nevertheless, whether it is shuhuda means they are alive, or shuhud means they are always present there, but this is a sign of strength. So Allah Azza wa Jal says, I am the one who gave him the money, I am the one who gave him the children and the power. وَمَهَدْتُ لَهُ تَمْهِيدًا, and I gave him more and more. Tamheed, from the word tamheed, you make things smooth. Like if there is a rough road, a road that's bumpy road or a rough road, and you make tamheed for the road, that means you make it smooth, you smoothen it out, you remove all the obstacles, all the problems. So Allah Azza wa Jal is saying that this person who is standing in your face, this person who is trying to delude the people from Islam, or to say some nasty words about the Quran, or to hide the truth about the Quran, I am the one who gave him the power, so do not worry, I can handle him. And then continues, ثُمَّ يَطْمَعُ أَنْ أَزِيدُ, and still he hopes that I give him more more wealth, to get more. What happened to the microphone out of a sudden? Huh? Oh, I see. Okay. Yeah. So this is continues to be a description for the power of Al-Walid, reminding that that yes, he is powerful, yes, he has money, yes, he has children, yes, he has lots of wealth, and he continues, he wants even more and more, but nevertheless, Allah Azza wa Jal still says, I will take care of him. إِنَّهُ كَلَّا, then Allah says, كَلَّا, no, and this is, remember, we mentioned this in Surah Iqra, the way Allah Azza wa Jal always uses this word of negation, كَلَّا لَإِن لَمْ يَنْتَهِ, كَلَّا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَيَطْغَى, كَلَّا إِن رَآهُ اسْتَغْنَى. All of this, no, that is just to make like a full stop. Wait, this is not accepted. Like in this ayah, يَطْمَعُ وَنْ أَزِيدْ, he likes me to give him more. No, Allah Azza wa Jal says, no, I will not do that, because إِنَّهُ كَانَ لِآيَاتِنَا عَنِيدًا. That's the catch here. Why Allah Azza wa Jal does not want to give him more? Why Allah Azza wa Jal wants to deal with him, to handle him on behalf of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Because إِنَّهُ كَانَ لِآيَاتِنَا عَنِيدًا. And he uses this word, the anid is stubborn. Now, Allah here is not talking about this person is totally from the kufr perspective. Now, he was a kafir, but at this moment, Al-Walid was still negotiating with himself. He was thinking. He was still looking at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as he has something new. He was looking at the Quran as this is something that it can be believed in. So Al-Walid was seeing something good. But the problem is stubbornness. إِنَّهُ كَانَ لِآيَاتِنَا عَنِيدًا. So this man is stubborn, meaning that he sees the truth. You know, he sees the argument, he sees the fact. But then there is a reason, there is some reason in his brain that blocks his faith. He doesn't want to. And there is a difference between someone, he doesn't see it, or he doesn't understand it, or he doesn't get it, or he doesn't want to believe in it in the first place, or someone who sees that you are on the right path, what you are saying is correct, but nevertheless, I will oppose you. Why? Now, Allah here says he was anid, stubborn. In another place, there was explanation about Abu Jahl, not Al-Walid. There is a story similar. When Abu Jahl was at one point, he almost expressed the same feelings like Al-Walid. Like this Quran, this Islam, it doesn't seem to be wrong after all. So he made some comments about the Quran. And the people approached Abu Jahl and they wanted a clarification from him. Are you in the process of accepting Islam? Are you thinking about it? Do you have a change of heart? So Abu Jahl made this statement that it doesn't matter whether Muhammad, peace be upon him, is right or wrong. It doesn't matter whether the Quran is the word of Allah or not. It doesn't matter all of that. What really matters is that we will not allow Bani Hashim to be in a superior position to Bani Makhzum. Bani Hashim is the tribe of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Bani Makhzum is the tribe of Abu Jahl. That is kibriya. That's arrogance. That's another reason. So Allah Azza wa Jal was revealing a reason, and that is in Surah At-Takathur. Alhaakum At-Takathur hatta zurtum al-maqabir. When you make the tafsir on that and you read it, you will find that story about Abu Jahl and how he said that we, Bani Makhzum and Bani Hashim, we were just like two horses in a race. كَفَرَسَيِّ رِهَان. We were two horses in the race, in the track, and where people were bidding on us who is going to win, until we were sitting on our knees in front of one another, which means no one is superior to other. We were all at the same level. And now here they have a prophet and we don't have a prophet. Then of course Bani Hashim are going to win. I'm not going to allow that. And here Al-Walid bin Mughira, Allah Azza wa Jal is saying he was anid. So this characteristic of stubbornness, being stubborn, sometimes we think of this trait or characteristic lightly. To be a stubborn is not a good characteristic. Because being a stubborn means that you hold onto your idea even though you see that your idea might be wrong. You continue to hold on your idea despite the fact that something else can be right. So this very concept of, sometimes some people like this, I'm stubborn, I'm just like that. So being a stubborn is not good, but being rightful is good. Rightful means I accept the fact as is. Wherever the fact is a fact, I will accept it. I cannot deny facts. You cannot deny al-haq. Al-haq shall not be denied at any rate. And here Allah Azza wa Jal is saying, إِنَّهُ كَانَ لِآيَاتِنَا عَنِيدًا. He was stubborn when it comes to our ayat. And then, سَأُرْهِقُهُ صَعُودًا. And that comes, I'm going to punish him in a manner that is, صَعُودًا means he will be ascending in an uphill, if you will, in a manner that is going to exhaust him. Which is, that's very general. سَأُرْهِقُهُ صَعُودًا. صَعُود means going up, going uphill. And you will be exhausted going uphill. Now sometimes if you go uphill for a few minutes, you can handle that. But if you keep going and going and going continuously, there is a limit where beyond which you cannot go. You will be absolutely exhausted. In the tafsir, they use the word Sa'uda is a mountain in Jahannam. So you are in Jahannam and you are climbing a mountain in Jahannam. So it's even worse than just being punished in Jahannam. But the ayah, سَأُرْهِقُ صَعُودًا, it is in very general term. It doesn't explicitly refer to something in Jahannam, but Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this impression that this person, because of his stubbornness, he will continue as if he is going fighting an uphill battle. He will be always going up, not higher, but is going in an ascending manner, where he is going to be tired and tired and tired. And that's what stubbornness does. If you are stubborn, your stubbornness will always get you in an exhaustive position. You will be always exhausted. You will be tired. You cannot relax because you cannot accept facts. And think about it this way. What really makes anyone comfortable? Once you have a fact, let's say you are searching on something and you find the fact, you find something right. You get the fact, khalas, you get it. But if you continue to argue, and you don't accept the fact, so you will be always in search of something that you will never get. And that is a tiring issue. And here Allah Azza wa Jal is referring to this concept in general, that stubbornness is a pretext for someone to be always exhausting himself in a search of something that he will never get, besides the punishment. So of course this person is, Allah Azza wa Jal is mentioning that it is it's a punishment for him from Allah Azza wa Jal, but more so it is a very general term that stubbornness will always lead to this type of exhaustive acts. Why? Here, because sometimes you say, okay, anid, stubborn, how? What did he do? Then comes the ayah, innahu fakkara wa qaddar. He was thinking about the Quran. And when he thought about the Quran, when he read it, when somebody read it to him, he compared that Quran with the poetry of Arabs. He compared the Quran with the words of the Arabs, with his words. He said, this is not similar to what I say. This Quran, like, يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثَّرْ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ وَثِيَابَكَ فَطَهِّرْ, that is very supreme, very high. It is way beyond what the most beautiful Arab poetry is. اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق, اقرأ وربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم, علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Those are beautiful words. These are absolutely superb. He cannot compare them to anything of what the Arabs were saying. So when he made his thinking, when he was thinking about that, somebody is sabotaging that speaker. Huh? It was up, and I moved it down. Like this? You think so?
Yeah, there is.
Ah. So he was making this thinking, and anyone who thinks about the Quran, whether you are a Muslim or non-Muslim, you think about the Quran, you will definitely come to the conclusion that this is something different than what the people say. That's not a statement which comes from people. Why? Because you have thousands or millions of texts written or spoken by people, by poets, by philosophers, and you can compare. So you have enough literature to compare against. And Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, he was not a naive or a layman person. He was a poet himself. He knew the, and he said, إني لأعلمكم بكلام العرب. I know the words of Arabs more than any one of you. إني لأعلمكم. I know all of that. And this is not similar. This Quran is absolutely not similar. It is different. And this is when the way he was putting it actually gives us a methodology to say, how do we know, as even if I today I want to stand and say, how do I know that this Quran is from Allah Azza wa Jal? What is the method? What is the technique of understanding that this is, because this is the mu'jiza of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And say, look, based on what was revealed right at the very beginning and what Allah Azza wa Jal is challenging the people, he challenged, فَلْيَأْتُوا بِآيَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ, let them bring at least one ayah similar to this, فَلْيَأْتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِّن مِثْلِهِ, in another place, bring a surah, or 10 surahs, or 10 surahs. So the challenge is that the people cannot make anything like the Quran. And that's what Al-Walid discovered right from the very beginning. He discovered that this Quran is different from what the people say. What does that mean? It means the following. This book, which was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam from Allah Azza wa Jal, it has one of three probabilities. It's either Muhammad was composing it, or it was composed by some of the Arabs, or it's indeed from Allah Azza wa Jal. It is something that must have a source. It doesn't come by itself. So it's a book that has a source. It has some place where it came from. And from the people's perspective, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the one who is reading it. So the first target, Muhammad is making that. Now, of course, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not make it. We know what Muhammad speaks. We know his hadith. His hadiths are compiled. And you compare the Quran with the hadith, it's totally different. Different in style. And we have the hadiths of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and take any hadith, even the hadiths which are like mutawatir. بني الإسلام على خمس. It's a state. بني الإسلام على خمس. شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. That's a word. And here, يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر والرجز فهجر. That's different. That's totally different. And there are hadiths of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم that talks about Allah عز وجل, like الإيمان. What is Islam? الإسلام من سلم الناس من لسانه ويده. الإسلام أن تؤمن بأن تشهد الشهادتين وأن تقيم الصلاة وتؤتي الزكاة. Many حديث. But the Quran, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق, اقرأ وربك الأكرم. That's different. So people already know that this is different. And also about the Arabs, well, if it was from the Arabs, if the Arabs have done the Quran, then they would have done another Quran, because the Quran is different totally from the poetry that the Arabs had. So thinking wise, from this perspective, Al-Walid, when he listened to the Quran, he immediately realized that this Quran cannot be the words of Muhammad, and it's different from all the poetry of the Arabs, so it has to be from Allah Azza wa Jal. So that's his tafkir. That is his tafkir. That's his thinking. Thinking is what? Thinking is, I apply my knowledge to a fact in front of me. The fact in front of him was the Quran which was read by Abu Bakr to him. That was the reality. And the knowledge he has about the poetry, about the literature, about the Arabs, about the poets, about his own style, all of his knowledge, that's what he has. He applied his knowledge to the Quran which was read in front of him, and he arrived at the conclusion that this cannot be from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It cannot from people. Cannot be from people. So it has to be from Allah Azza wa Jal. That is how he thought. That's the regular thinking. Now, aside from thinking, sometimes the people, they have something called fiqh al-muwazanat. This is muwazana, means the balance between two issues. Let's do some estimations, some judgments, how do I call this, al-muwazana, some compromise, if you will, some compromise between two things. Yeah, I know that this is from Allah, I know this is the Quran, but, you know, sometimes when you say it, but, I know you are right. I know what you are saying is Islam has to prevail, Islam has to rule, Islam must be the system that will rule the world. I know that, but, you know, in a world like the world we are living today, we simply cannot do that. Let's have a middle way. Let's do something. That, the moment you are saying, but, I know what you are saying, I believe in that, I accept it, however, that however, that but, that lakin, is a taqdir. That is what Al-Walid got into because of the pressure of the people. I know that this Quran is not from Muhammad. I know it cannot be the word of al-Bashar, of people. But I cannot say that. I have to say something else. I know that the economic system in Islam is the one that has to rule and can resolve the problems of the world. But today we cannot live without riba, without banks. How can we live? We have to find a middle way, some way. We know that the world or the Muslim world must have a khilafa to rule them. But khilafa cannot be introduced to the people today. That is too rough. So let's make it somewhere in between. Let's have a constitution that has mixture between some Islamic rules and some non-Islamic rules. We have to satisfy the needs of the Christians and the Jews and the Americans and the Muslims. That is the but. That's al-taqdir. So Al-Walid bin al-Mughira, he got into this, al-taqdir. So yeah, I know this is what the Quran, now fakkara wa qaddar. Now, condemned he based on what? What was he condemned for? Not his tafkir, but his taqdir. قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرُ. And this is what the Quran says. فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرُ. Condemned, he was condemned now for القتل. This is again Arabic expression. Sometimes قتل does not necessarily mean killed. Okay? قتل could be just like ثكلتك أمك in Arabic. There is ثكلتك أمك. May your mother lose you. Well, may your mother lose you, that means you die. But it's an expression to say that you are wrong. Or that is wrong. You shouldn't be in this situation. So فقتل, it's an expression of condemnation. So he is condemned. Condemned he for what? For his taqdeer. And that is very important for us today to understand. Once I arrive at a conclusion, if it's a fact and if it's a conclusion, that's what I will stand for. I cannot retreat from the conclusion. Now I may not be able to do it. I can refrain. I can stay back. I may be afraid to mention it or to talk about it. Okay, that's a different story. But I cannot look for alternative. The fact that a conclusion or a fact that arrive at is so strong, so powerful, it can put me in jeopardy and I'm too afraid to announce it. That is one thing, but to look for alternative, to say something else to change the fact, that is haram. That's not allowed. That's not allowed. That's Al-Walid was condemned for that. He was condemned for this at-taqdeer. So at-taqdeer, or the middle way between Islam and kufr, or between al-haq and al-batil, that taqdeer is absolutely unacceptable. And that is one of the major problems we have today with the people who are in the da'wah, so-called da'wah missions, or Islamic activities. We have lots of problems with those who will always say, yeah, we know the fact, we know what is right, but we cannot do it, so let's say something else. We know that Islam is the one and only one that should rule, but today we cannot do that, so let's talk about al-dawla al-madaniya, for example, civil state. And civil state, actually, it does include Islam in it. After all, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a civil person. He was not a savage person. After all, the khulafa, they were civil people. So that is something in between. That is taqdeer. That's not allowed. Don't do that. You either go for Islam, you cannot do it, stay back. There are people in Mecca who realized that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a prophet. They could not announce it. They could not come up openly and say Muhammad is a prophet and the Quran is the word of Allah Azza wa Jal, but they were in hiding. They stayed behind. But they never pronounced anything that's contrary to what they think. فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرْ. And then Allah Azza wa Jal repeats that ثُمَّ قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرْ. And then he indeed was condemned one more time for the way he had he made taqdeer. Now in the tafsir, interesting, they say the first one, قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرْ, it was a condemnation for his act, a condemnation for his act in Mecca. And then when he said, ثُمَّ قُتِلَ, then indeed he was, that is, killed for reality. That was condemnation for being killed. Indeed, Al-Walid bin al-Maghira was one of the first people killed in Badr. So in the tafsir, they bring this, they said, this was a notion, an indication that this man will be killed and his words are going to be the reason for him to fight in the battle of Badr against Islam and not to be a Muslim. And in fact, just like in the Surah Abu Lahab, where some of the scholars, they said, to prove that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was wrong, all it took for Al-Walid bin al-Mughira to change his word and to accept Islam. So these ayat would have been revealed wrong. You know, Al-Walid bin Mughira after these words says, okay, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam condemned me to be for death because of what I have said. Now I accept Islam. What happens to this ayat? This ayat become wrong. So he would prove that these ayat were wrong. But here Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who is talking. Meaning that this person was condemned for what he made taqdeer, and indeed he will be killed as a result, and he was. The same thing for Surah Abu Lahab. When the ayah was revealed, تَبَّتْ يَدَا أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبْ, and when it said, سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبْ, he will definitely be he be punished with a hellfire, and he will taste that, the taste of the fire. All it took from Abu Lahab to prove Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was wrong and the Quran was wrong is to accept Islam. To say, okay, Muhammad, now I accept Islam, I am a Muslim. What happens to this surah? This surah becomes, there is a contradiction. And that never happened. Abu Lahab died as a kafir. And then, just to finish this before we stop for a break, to this scenario, here Allah Azza wa Jal is giving us this, the style of Quran, as I we mentioned earlier. Sometimes it gives you a visualization. It makes it, the story, as if you are looking at it. It says, ثُمَّ نَظَرْ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرْ. He thought, and then he made estimations. And then after a while, ثُمَّ نَظَرْ. Then he looked around. ثُمَّ عَبَسَ وَبَسَرْ. Then he frowned, and he looked so mad. He doesn't know what to do. He's frustrated, he's confused. نَظَرْ عَبَسَ وَبَسَرْ means confused. What is he going to do? He knows what's the fact. Now he has to say something else. And the people know, the people, the Arabs, they know what he thinks. So he is confused between two things. ثُمَّ نَظَرْ. He was started looking. ثُمَّ عَبَسَ وَبَسَرْ. Then he's confused. He frowns. His face and his expressions and complexions turn different. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرْ. Then he says he rushes. أَدْبَرْ means he turns his back and he leaves. You know, just he says, okay, forget it. I'm not going to say what I believe. I will say something. ثُمَّ أَدْبَرْ. وَاسْتَكْبَرْ. واستكبر means from the word استكبار. استكبار, he felt haughty. He became haughty, arrogant. That arrogance type of thing, just like عنيد, stubborn, and also arrogance. Stubbornness and arrogance, they go hand in hand. What makes you arrogant? Arrogant, what is arrogant? You know, arrogant sometimes, you don't see me in a good eye. You look at me, you look down at me. You look down at people. You don't really want to admit that you are humble, that you are a created being. You don't want to admit the fact that you are a human. You are something beyond, you are super. That's istikbar, that's istikbar, that's arrogance. So this person, after some point, after thinking and moving and confused and all of these, adbara, wastakbar, nazara, abasa, basara, all of these things, adbara, then he became arrogant. Just like, and this word, when Allah Azza wa Jal used the word istakbar, arrogant, remember that he used this word for Iblis. Remember when Iblis was told to bow down to Adam alayhi salam? In, وَذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Allah Azza wa Jal told the angels that I'm making a khalifa on earth, and then he said, وَذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمْ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ أَبَى وَاسْتَكْبَرْ. Everybody bowed down, every one of them bowed to Adam except Iblis. He rejected and he was arrogant. استكبر. أبا واستكبر. This Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira adbara واستكبر. Just like Iblis. Just like Iblis when he refused the order of Allah Azza wa Jal when he created Adam, this man, he refused and he rejected the order of Allah Azza wa Jal when he designated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a messenger. Muhammad is a messenger, he has the Quran, he has all the evidence in front of his hand, and the man, he looks at the evidence, he sees that. Well, Iblis, he saw the evidence in front of his own eyes. He saw the creation. He knew that Adam was created by Allah. He knew that Adam was someone that Allah Azza wa Jal preferred. He knew that Adam alayhi salam was given the knowledge. He knew, he saw all of that. But Aba wastakbar. He rejected and he became arrogant. This man, Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira, Adbara wastakbar. He ran away, he turned his back, and he was مستكبر. سأصليه and then فقال إن هذا إلا سحر يؤثر. Now he came with his conclusion. Okay, this is سحر. This is سحر. It's not the magic which people play with magicians, just like the magicians of Musa عليه السلام. سحر means this charismatic effect of the words. You know, somebody's like Shakespeare. He talks, he can change the minds of the people based on his words. Some orator, some speaker, some people who are really very good speakers, they can make a difference. They can impact the way the people think based on their ideas, based on their words, based on their poetry. So he said, this is the type of words that can make impact on the people. سِحْرٌ يُؤْثَر, it means it is a sihr. It's this magic power of the words which can make an impact and influence on the people. إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, it is the words of people. إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, and he changed against his own thought, because his own thought, this is not the word of the bashar. Now he says, this is قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ. He makes he turns against his own conclusion, إِنْ هَذَا إِلَّا قَوْلُ الْبَشَرِ, and then Allah Azza wa Jal, now he says, سَأُصْلِيهِ سَقَرِ. Now comes the real punishment. I will definitely lead him into سقر. And the word أُصْلِيهِ, the word أُصْلِي, الصلي in Arabic is to feel the heat. You know, sometimes when you put your hand on a stove, you say, صَلَتْنِ النَّارِ. صَلَتْنِ means it touched my hand and I felt it. So the word صَلَى, أَصْلَ النَّارِ, or the fire touched you, it means there is the feeling of actual contact. Now, the reason I'm bringing this notion here, because some people sometimes they talk about this metaphor. They say An-Nar and Jahannam and all of this, there is a metaphor. The metaphor for punishment, but there is not really fire. So Allah Azza wa Jal, he brings the words in the Quran that indicate realities. Because the word asli, salan nar, you will not use this word until and unless the fire is real. So sometimes you say, I felt the heat. You know, I am too hot. Meaning that I am either exhausted from within, or it means the condition is hot, or the AC is turned off. That is a metaphoric sense of being warm. But when you said صَلَتْنِ النَّارِ, صَلَتْنِ النَّارِ means something has touched your hand, your skin. Something has come in contact with your skin, so you felt the heat of the fire. So when Allah Azza wa Jalla says سَأُصْلِيهِ سَقَر, it means that سَقَر, in this case Jahannam, is real, it's not metaphoric. So that puts an end to the argument of metaphor right from the very beginning. So later, when the Quran talks about the azab of Jahannam, the punishment of Jahannam, when people start talking about metaphor, they miss this ayah. They miss the ayah like in Surah Al-Masad. تَبَّتْ يَدَ أَبِي لَهَبٍ وَتَبَّ مَا أَغْنَ عَنْهُ مَالُهُ مَا كَسَبْ سَيَصْلَى نَارًا. He used the word, the same word, سَيَصْلَى, means he will touch, his skin will come in direct contact with the flame. سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ, he will be burned with a fire, with flame. That means it's real, it's not metaphor. So all of these people, sometimes they say, oh, many things in the Quran talks about metaphoric things, like Jannah is metaphor. He's talking about metaphor, just to give you the feeling that there is something good, but there is nothing called Jannah. There is nothing called Jahannam, it's only the metaphor. That is absolutely superb. That's absolutely absurd. That's not right. That's incorrect. And that means the people do not understand the language. The language here, when Allah Azza wa Jal uses those words, they do mean the exact impact, the exact contact between fire and the skin. سَيَصْلَى نَارًا ذَاتَ لَهَبٍ. Here he says, سَأُصْلِيهِ سَقَرٍ. I will make him in contact with سَقَر, so he will feel the heat of سَقَر, the heat of نار جهنم. So those things, right from the very beginning, when we say, when you read the Quran based on the revelation, those ayat at the beginning they give us some of the basic rules. So from these rules we start building our knowledge. Because sometimes if you jump in the middle and you start getting some of the ayat, some of the things that could imply metaphor, you are missing what you got at the beginning. And Allah Azza wa Jal will not, doesn't have to repeat every time the same words. Because this was revealed and finished, it's done. So he established the fact. So established the fact that Saqar is a reality, and therefore if he is punishing someone like Al-Walid in Saqar, it is going to be a Saqar that makes Sali, Tasla, contact with the skin of the body. Sa'uslihi Saqar. وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا Saqar. And then it continues. Let's stop for a few minutes here. We have been going on for almost hour. So let's take a few break and get some comments, Q&A, questions. Go ahead. Well, Jazakallah khair. I mentioned some of the similarities, but you went a little bit farther than me. Like when I talked about at-tafkir wa at-taqdir, some of the similarities where people today, they think about Islam, they find the truth, but then they have to make balances between the reality and what they think. And that should not be done, because we immediately take that this is an issue that's condemned. The other thing is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because Islam is just coming, and Islam is already putting this supremacy to Allah Azza wa Jal, is nothing but Allah Azza wa Jal. So the people who are in charge of the society, those who benefit from the current status quo, they wouldn't like that. That's why Al-Walid bin Mughira and Abu Jahl stood against Islam. That's what istikbar means. That's what stubbornness means. So Islam defies their own trust. Islam of time Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it says that it will strip them some of the power and the authority they have. So they stand against Islam. Now in today's similarity, when you preach Islam, when you want Islam to prevail, we say we want the Islamic system to rule. Who is going to stop against that? Why? Who is bothered by this? What mentality? Who is the stubborn or the arrogant who are going to say, no, we will not allow Islam to prevail? Well, the ones who have the authority, the ones who are benefiting from the system of kufr being implemented. Like in capitalism, everybody knows that less than 5% of the people control more than 80% of the wealth. So those who control the wealth, the 5% who control the wealth, or the 1%, I don't even think it's 5%. Probably it's less than 1%. Or maybe sometimes they say it's only on your fingers of your hand, which means about 10 families or so, you count them by your fingers. Those who benefit from the status quo. So when you say, I need to implement a system that allows a natural distribution of the wealth, such that the wealth finds its way to all the people and does not remain concentrated, كَيْ لَا يَكُونَ دُولَةً بَيْنَ الْأَغْنِيَاءِ مِنْكُمْ. If you come up to a system, to a society, and you say, I want to build a system with economy such that كي لا يكون دولة بين الأغنياء منكم, so that the money does not remain confined to the hands of the few, the rich few. Of course, the few rich one, the ones who have the power and the money, they wouldn't like that. And they will stop against you, just like Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira. Stubborn, just like Abu Jahl. Stubborn and arrogant and does not want Islam to prevail. So there is always the authorities, the ones who are in power, in charge, the ones who control the rules, the systems that run a society. If they see that your Islam or the Islam you are bringing will impact their ability to exploit and their ability to rule in a manner that makes them powerful and rich, of course they will not allow it. But the majority of the people, the ones who are who will benefit from Islam, they will not oppose it. They will not oppose, they will not strongly oppose it. They may not believe. You know, you may find people who will not believe it. They don't get it. That's fine. But for someone to know that you are right, just like the Patrick Buchanan when he was writing this his article about an Islam, it's an idea whose time has come. And he says the power of Islam is that the idea is simple, the idea makes sense, the idea can unite the people, the idea can provoke the inner energy of the people. Man, what stops you from believing in it then? If you see all of this, why you are not becoming a Muslim? When during the financial crisis, the French economy or financial minister, she was a woman, she said, we have learned a lot in Islam that Islam can resolve all our financial crises. Obama designated someone from his cabinet to go and study Islamic finances. Now, if you know that Islam has the solutions, why don't you become Muslims? Why don't you allow Islam? Why don't you stop the progress of Islam? That means the elites, they know the facts. They know Islam is correct. But they don't want it. And that's exactly what happened at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So for governments and systems and power to oppose Islam does not necessarily mean they don't accept it or they don't think it's correct. In fact, on the contrary, they know it's correct. But they want to oppose it. But Allah Azza wa Jal, the good thing, when He says, ذَرْنِي وَمَنْ خَلَقْتُ وَحِيدًا, I will handle that. Yeah, you have all those people who oppose you, I mean powers, because the ones who oppose you are not the weak. You are opposed by the people like Fir'aun. Musa was opposed by Fir'aun. Fir'aun saw the facts in front of him. He saw that the Musa, his snake, swallowed the fake snakes of his magicians. He saw that in front of his own eyes. Musa saw the sea, I mean Fir'aun saw the sea being split in two halves. One is watery and one is solid. He saw that. And he made a plea to the God of Musa alayhi salam, which is Allah Azza wa Jal, and he saved him. He saw all of these. But then he was mustakbir. He opposed Musa and opposed the deen of Musa alayhi salam because that's the life of Fir'aun. The life of Fir'aun because he enslaves people. So that was exactly what happened in Mecca. In Mecca, Abu Jahl, Al-Walid, Abu Lahab, Abu Sufyan, all these, they used to enslave the people of Mecca. Why should they allow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his deen to prevail? To make Bilal Sayyid. You know, Bilal al-Habashi, whenever we say Bilal, we say Sayyidina Bilal radiyallahu anhu. Until now, 1400 years later, we say Sayyidina Bilal. He was a slave. According to the hadith, رأسه كزبيبا. عبد الحبشي, he is an Abyssinian عبد, slave. Until today we say سيد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم والحمد لله رب العالمين حمد الشاكرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. Before I continue the tafsir tonight, inshallah, I will just say a few words on
the event that the uncle of our brother Asim has passed away this past week. So may Allah Azza wa Jal grant him the mercy and the forgiveness. And this is every time there is an issue of death, someone passes away, we are always reminded of this fact that this life, no matter how it extends, how long it stays, it will always reach an end. So our life is not a permanent one, it's a temporary one. And the fact that we are departing this life is we get reminded of this every time someone among us, among our brothers, passes away. We ask Allah Azza wa Jal to provide the forgiveness and the mercy for those who leave this world, and to enable us, those who stay behind, to take advantage of whatever days left in our lives, to worship Allah Azza wa Jal, to perform the good deeds, so that we may gain His mercy, His forgiveness, and His support, and that Allah Azza wa Jal will enable us to leave this world with the best of heart and the best of deeds. And also, we are always reminded that Allah Azza wa Jal gave the best aza to His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when He told him in the Quran in several ayat, "Afa in mitta fahumul khalidun." If you die, do you think that anyone else will be mortal, will be immortal after you die? If we had made this life an everlasting one, then it would have been to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the fact that Muhammad, peace be upon him, passed away means that no one will be left in this world. And that is our best aza. And when Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu passed away, his daughter was saying that if we had, your death was so sad, but the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was even more of a regrettable event, so that after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no death of any person is really that serious. That's the essence. So that's the quick introduction here. Again, may Allah Azza wa Jal have His rahmah and forgiveness for our brother and for all the Muslims who have passed away, especially the ones who are suffering these days in Syria, the ones who are being killed and tortured and murdered at the hands of the brutal regime of Bashar al-Assad. May Allah Azza wa Jal give them the support, those who stay alive behind, and give the mercy and the forgiveness for all those who vanish in this war. And may Allah Azza wa Jal grant the victory for the believers. Again, let me remind of the surah al-Muddathir that we are covering. And just a quick recap or overview of what we have said so far. Remember that this surah al-Muddathir that was revealed in the early days of the revelation. Most of the narrations say and confirm that it was the second surah revealed after Surah Al-Alaq, Iqra. Some scholars, they even say that Al-Muddathir and Al-Muzzammil and Iqra, they were revealed almost within the same short period of time, at least the first few ayat. And when we looked at the meanings of the ayat of Surah Al-Muddathir, starting from قُلْ or يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرْ قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ, O you who had taken cover, stand up and convey the message of Allah Azza wa Jal. And then gave him the instructions to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam what he should do. So this was the beginning of the message. So the Iqra was the beginning of the introduction of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to prophethood. That he is receiving a revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal. Now with Al-Muddathir and Al-Muzzammil, he is being told, now stand up and convey this message. And the Surah starts with showing that the opposition to this message began as early as the da'wah started. So from the very first days when this Islam was known, or this revelation, this wahi, it was known to have been revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, declaring that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one and only one Rabb, He is the only one and only one who can be worshipped, and all of these idols around the Kaaba are null and void, and they don't count, and they have no value whatsoever. Then it is expected, or as expected, those who were benefiting from the worship of idols, remember, idols are not gods. Idols don't do any good or bad. And no one in his right mind would assume or even think that those idols are really gods. But it was a matter of this type of if you will, exploitation of the benefiting from this worship of idols by some elites. So the idol worshipping, it was like a business. It's something that someone is benefiting from there. Because Mecca or Quraysh and the elites of Quraysh, they were benefiting from people coming to Mecca and worshipping idols. They used to sell them the souvenirs of idols. They used to charge them all types of customs and duties. So the people of Quraysh, they were benefiting from that, and they had the prestige of being the custodians of Al-Baytul Haram, although Al-Baytul Haram was filled with idols. So the opposition to Islam, and for some people to stand up against this new messenger, new deen, new Islam, was expected. And the Quran depicts that and tells us that indeed it was. And it showed us, as we talked in the last couple of sessions, that there is, it portrays the picture of one of the leaders, Al-Walid bin al-Mughira, who stands up in the face of Islam and who starts saying all types of nasty things about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as in Surah Al-Qalam, saying he's a majnoon, he's a fool. In this surah, saying he's a sahir. This is magician, this is some type of magic. This is some type of playing with the words on the minds of the people, twisting the minds of the people. And the Quran depicts this picture and portrays this man by saying, إِنَّهُ فَكَّرَ وَقَدَّرَ فَقُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ ثُمَّ قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. He thought carefully about this Islam, and then he made his estimates, his evaluation of the situation, what he is going to say. Then he said the nasty, the bad, the wrong things about Islam, and Allah Azza wa Jal vowed to have him punished and said, قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. Death be to him the way he made this evaluation. ثُمَّ قُتِلَ كَيْفَ قَدَّرَ. Indeed, he shall die once he is done, because he has done what he has done. And then he talked about the way he played the game. إنه نظر ثم عبس وبصر ثم أدبر واستكبر. He looked aside, he frowned, he ran away, he rushed, he turned his back. And he shows all of this type of scenario, the way this man behaved himself. And that does not, as we spoke also last time, it really resembles the way the elites and the leaders of societies act today. So it's not something unique to Mecca. It is something typical to societies and to communities where there is a leadership that opposes the rise of Islam. That's very typical. It's typical to current regimes in the Muslim world, to world leaders, to world organizations, where they really try to find out how are we going to label this Islam. We label it with terrorism, with fundamentalism, with extremism. Just give it a label, say something that will deter people, will push the people away from this Islam. So that's the gist of the whole idea. Then Allah Azza wa Jal talked about Jahannam. Now, for the first introduction again, for the Islam and the Muslims, that there is this reward and punishment. Because Islam is being introduced and the message of Islam is being given. Now, the first notion of Jahannam, which is called Saqar in this surah, meaning the very, very hot, abrasive type of thing, it is Saqar, and it's real. We mentioned last time, it's real. It's not metaphoric, it's not imaginary, it's real. Because Allah Azza wa Jal used the word Sa'uslihi Saqar, and the word Sala Yasla will not be used for anything metaphoric. Sometimes you say you feel the heat. Feeling the heat of something, it can be metaphoric. But yasla, it means there is a contact between the skin and the fire. That's the word yasla. Sa'uslihi saqar. And in between, before Allah Azza wa Jal continues to talk about this issue of Jahannam and the day after, there is a pause, if you will. There is this interrupt to make some notation about how do people perceive Jahannam, the way they think when Allah Azza wa Jal says, okay, this is Saqar, and there will be 19 angels will be guarding Jahannam. Then he interjects that with the notion that the kuffar, how the kuffar perceive that, how the munafiqeen perceive it, how the people of the book perceive that. And that we talked about it, but that is, it's like an interrupting statement. Then Allah Azza wa Jal continues, like in the سأصليه سقر وما أدراك ما سقر لا تبقي ولا تذر لواحة للبشر عليها 19. And then that is the talking about سقر وما جعلنا أصحاب النار. In fact, the number that we have given, which is 19, and continues. We talked about that. So then after this ayah, which is a long ayah, resumes, and this is the Quranic style. Sometimes it's talking about an issue, it leaves that issue for some dispute. Like there is an argument, someone is injecting an argument, so the Quran argues with that and then continues. That's a Quranic style. So the Quran talks about Saqar, which is Jahannam. It says lawahatun lilbashar, it changes the skin. لا تبقي ولا تذر, does not leave anything behind. It just eliminates everything from whatever it finds. It just finishes with it. عليها 19, it is guarded by 19. Then period, stop, talks about an argument, and the Quran argues with that and makes the point or the statement that the Quran wants to make. Then resumes, then continues. Because sometimes you would say, oh, here is the Quran is saying about Saqar, it is guarded by 19. وَمَا جَعَلْنَا أَصْحَابَ النَّارِ إِلَّا فِتْنَةً. We have made إِلَّا مَلَائِكَ وَمَا جَعَلْنَا عِدَّتَهُمْ. The guards of Jahannam are angels, and the number, we have used this number as a test for the following categories of people. It's a test for the people of the book, so the people of the book would know that this matches information they have. It's a test for the people, the kuffar, who are going to disbelieve in it, simply because they don't believe in God at all at the beginning. And it is something for the believers to add to their iman, just add one extra piece of information that's added to their belief. And it is a test for the people who have some disease in their hearts. So this is, if you will, it's a slight deviation from the path. So there is a path talking about something, stop, make the argument, and then resume. Then go back to where you were. So when the next ayat, it comes and says, كَلَّا وَالْقَمَرِ, and that's where we stopped last time, ayah number 32. كَلَّا وَالْقَمَرِ وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرِ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرِ إِنَّهَا لَأَحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. Allah is making an oath here, says, I swear by the night, by the moon, at the beginning, by the moon, and then by the night that is leaving, at the time the night is over. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرِ. أَدْبَر means it turns its back away, it leaves. And by the night as it leaves this world, as it finishes up, which is mean that the light is coming. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرِ. And the morning and the day when it comes bright. I swear by those. إِنَّهَا لَأَحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. This Saqar that I talked about, Jahannam, the day of judgment, the punishment, the fact that the person and the elites and the ones who oppose Islam will be punished by this Jahannam, it is one of the biggest things. إِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. It doesn't say what big means, it just says it's one of the great events, one of the fantastic events, one of the tremendous events. It is something big. So there is talking about Saqar, talking about Jahannam, then talks about the people, the angels who guard it, then comes back and he makes a swear now. Now remember, the ayah before that, there was a dispute. There was an argument. Someone is arguing about the number. It's not really about the number of angels guarding, but the argument is about the fact that there is Jahannam. So this denial, The denial of the Jahannam, the denial of the Day of Judgment, the denial of accountability, the denial of the fact that Allah Azza wa Jal is the one who is making all of this scenario. There is a denial. Then here Allah Azza wa Jal, He does not leave that denial just to pass by without emphasizing that it's really a fact. And Allah Azza wa Jal is using this style and this technique that He uses in the Quran, which is an oath, where He says, وَاللَّيْلِ وَالْفَجْرِ وَالسَّمَاءِ. There is an oath, there is a swear, I swear by. And Allah Azza wa Jal, when He makes a swear, He makes an oath with things that He made. And those are signs of His creation. In like when He makes وَالشَّمْسِ وَضُحَاهَا, He swears by the sun and the rising after the sun. He swears by وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَى, by the night when it takes over. He swears by وَالْفَجْر, by the dawn and the 10 nights. And here He's making a swear by وَالْقَمَر, كَلَّا وَالْقَمَر. And in fact, the issue of the moon and the sun is repeated time and again in the Quran. But in this ayah, when I'm thinking about it, what is this relation, I mean the significance of making this oath with those things? Note that He's saying al-qamar, the moon, and then He says the night as it leaves, which means the end of a night, the end of the moon, the end of the night, which is end of darkness, and the morning, as-subh, idha asfar. Asfar means it opens up. In fact, the word asfar, we use it for as-sifr, when you talk about a woman, when she is leaving the hijab, or taking off a hijab, we say as-sufur. As-sufur means everything is open, you don't cover anything. So as-subh idha asfar means the morning has come open, has come light, with its light. It didn't leave any darkness behind. So the whole issue, the swear itself or the oath, is very important. Allah Azza wa Jal is making this oath with something light. The moon is bright, is coming with light. Even at night, it's not dark. And the dark night is over. And the morning is coming. It talks about the fact that, look, this Islam that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is coming up with, and that Al-Walid bin Mughira and the elites are opposing, it is coming like a night, like the moon. It will be so bright, it will be so light, it will penetrate the darkness of the kuffar. So this darkness of Jahiliyyah will be over. So the night is over means the Jahiliyyah of Abu Jahl and Al-Walid bin Mughira is over. The moon is up, and by the moon, which is rising, that means this Islam will be like a moon shining on the world. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرْ, it will be just like a daylight with the morning, that it brings all the light. So this whole issue of the swear, it's showing that it's not that Allah Azza wa Jal is saying by the moon and by the night and by the morning that Jahannam and the Day of Judgment is a reality. He's also giving this notion to the Muslims that this Islam that is being denied, this Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's being under the attack and the offense, he will be victorious. He will shine. This Islam will take over. This Islam will take over just like the morning will take over the night, and this Jahiliyyah will be out just like the night is being ended, and this moon will be in the middle of the sky shining on the world just like Islam will be doing so. And with all these signs being the creation of Allah Azza wa Jal, and Allah Azza wa Jal chooses and selects from His signs and the creation whatever He wishes. So He chose these events, the moon, the end of the night, and the morning, to declare that this is a fact, that إِنَّهَا لَأَحْدَى الْكُبَرِ, it is one of the great things. What is the great thing? Now it's up to you to understand it. It is the Day of Judgment, it's Islam, it's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's the message, all of it. It is a very great thing. إِنَّهَا لَأَحْدَى الْكُبَرِ نَذِيرًا لِلْبَشَرِ. And it's a warning for all people. Warning in this case means it is like an alert. It is something to alert the people that, look, something is coming up. When I say نذير, I want to give a nadir, like a warning. or alert. Something is happening. There is something is coming up. You don't make nadir for something that had passed. You make nadir for something coming up because you want to the people to avoid it. What do you make nadir for? Like inzar. You know, when we say the alarm goes off, fire alarm. There is alarm comes up. That means everybody has to leave because if you don't leave, something bad is going to happen. You can be burned, the house can collapse, you will get a flood, you will get some all types of destruction. That's what an alarm is. That's what we use alarms. That's what inzar. In fact, the word alarm in Arabic is translated into inzar. Nadir is the one who let this inzar go, let this alarm go. So someone triggers this alarm. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Islam is a trigger. Nadir is a trigger for the alarm, for an alarm. What is that alarm that is being triggered for? This alarm is that, look, Islam is coming. There is new regulations, new laws. You either abide by these laws or you will face the consequences. So that is the nadhiran lil bashar. So here is, it's a swear. Allah Azza wa Jal is making this. Kalla wal qamar. Wal layli idh adbar. And there is for those who understand the Arabic. Here Allah Azza wa Jal did not use the word idha. In the next one he says, was subhi idha asfar. Idha means if. There is a conditional. It's like an if, but this condition usually with the word idha, it is a condition that is happening. It's a condition, but it's a condition that will happen. It's not that a condition subject to the condition happening. But then the word idh, there is idh that doesn't have the alif at the end. And there is a difference between idh and idha. When he talks about a layl, says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرْ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرْ. So إِذْ أَدْبَرْ means at the moment it departs. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرْ. Right at the moment it departs. So when the night, there is a decisive point, a point that it's no longer night. So that is إِذْ, at the moment it happens. And the إِذَا أَسْفَرْ وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرْ وَالصُّبْحِ, when it says, when it happens. And it's with the word here, it gives you an extended period. إِذَا أَسْفَرْ, then the morning will take a long time to stay up and for it to materialize, to completely materialize. But a night, here Allah Azza wa Jal is putting it's like an abrupt point. There is a specific point. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرْ, there is a point, it's no longer night. So you don't even have to wait for something to say, oh, the night is fading away. Well, the Quran talks about the night fading away in a long process in another surah, وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. He says 10 nights, وَالْفَجْرِ وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ. But in this ayah he says, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذْ أَدْبَرٍ, at the time when the night is over. وَالصُّبْحِ إِذَا أَسْفَرٍ. So that is the just annotation we have to point to. And then the result, what is the subject here? What's the subject of this oath or this swear? إِنَّهَا لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. It is something big. It's something great. It's not something light. What we are talking about here is not something simple. It is لَإِحْدَى الْكُبَرِ. الْكُبَرِ, it's a plural of something كَبِير. كَبِير is big. كُبَر means those big things, one of those big things, one of those great things, one of those absolutely fantastic, awesome things, things which you admire, things which you really look and ponder upon. نَذِيرًا لِلْبَشَرِ. Now, for whom, of course? Then the ayah continues. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَتَقَدَّمَ أَوْ يَتَأَخَّرَ. It is an adhir, it's an alert, it's an alarm for anyone who wants to take advantage of this. To take advantage of this warning, which is يَتَقَدَّم, for those who want, يَتَقَدَّم means you want to progress. يَتَأَخَّر, to be backward. And this is very interesting because in the old days when socialism and communism was very was fashionable, if you will, they used to call everything that is leftist progress or progressive. You are progressive if you are not believing in Allah Azza wa Jal. You are progressive if you believe in socialism. You are progressive if you believe in those type of fancy ideas which they had. They use the word progress. And here Islam uses this word or this term even 1400 years earlier. He says, anyone who wants to make a progress, to move forward in general. If you want to move forward, this is, you take alert. You are alert of this warning. You take advantage of this warning. You appreciate this warning. You make sure that you get the essence of this warning so you know how to move forward. Now, if you want to move backward, it's up to you. So it's for anyone who hears this alarm coming up from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about the Day of Judgment and about Saqar and about all of this new Islam. If you take advantage of this, if you understand it, then you move forward. Then you run away from the hardship. You run away from the things that leads you into Saqar, and you move into the things that leads you into Jannah. So لمن شاء, here لمن شاء منكم أن يتقدم, for those among you who wish and who want to move forward, أو يتأخر. And here this ayah leaves it to the person. It's up to you. It's up to the person to take advantage of it. Allah Azza wa Jal is not forcing it upon anyone, saying I'm not forcing it upon you. I'm just giving it as a warning. I have this alert, I have this alarm, I have this prophet who has been designated, and he's taking all the responsibility, he's standing up, he's making the inzar. Remember, at the ayah starts with this, قُمْ فَأَنذَرْ. Stand up and be the person who triggers this alarm. Anzir, if we want to be the literal translation, or this visualize what's happening, stand up and trigger this alarm. Let the people hear all the sounds of the alarm and the warning and the bells ringing all over. So let the people hear this. And based on that also, you convey the message and you tell the people how to proceed, which way to go in order to avoid what you are being alarmed for. And then it's up to you. He says, لمن شاء, it's up to you, to the people, if you really want to move forward or what you want to move forward. So it's not something forced upon anyone. The only thing Allah Azza wa Jal forces are His signs, like Al-Qamar, the moon, the night, the day, and of course the other things that He had done in this world. Now, what is the consequence of that? Look, the flow of the ayat, think of it this way. Talking about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam standing up, being the nadir, triggering all of these alarms about the new deen, about the new religion, talking about someone who is opposing that, and then mentioning that there are consequences like Saqar, like Jannah, Jahannam, and there is a description of it. And then here Allah Azza wa Jalla says, this alarm is for those who want to take advantage to move forward or or backward. And after that, we'll have two categories of people. Some people will take advantage and some people will not. Some people will move forward, some people will move backward. Some people will go into Islam, some people will go into secularism. Some people will take this Islam and the notion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and be alert and be warned and just proceed with Islam. Some will proceed with kufr. Some will stay in jahiliyyah, some will go into Islam. Some will stay in the darkness, some will go in the moonlight. That's typical. And then with this categorization, the Quran gives these two categories a very interesting notion. The next ayah says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ رَهِنَا. Each soul will be confined to whatever it earns. And here, and the ayah after says, إِلَّا أَصْحَابَ الْيَمِينَ. Except for people who are on the right. And the word al-yameen, although it's al-yameen, it means on the right-hand side, and also it means, go in the English, right and right. Right means rightfulness, and right means on the right. And that is an expression which has been used almost globally, worldwide, that on the right means the right, And whenever you want to talk about something that's negative, you go on the left. And this notion in the Quran has been used, and it's an expression by the Quran. So we will take, if you want to talk about the copyright, it's the copyright of the Quran. So this right and left, the Quran has used it extensively. Ashab al-Yameen and Ashab al-Shimal, the people of the Yameen, of the right, and the people of the left. The people of the Yameen, of the right, are the ones who are on the right hand, on the right side. They are on the truthfulness side, and the one on the left, the ones who are wrong. So here Allah Azza wa Jal says there will be two categories of people after all of this warning. لِمَنْ شَاءَ مِنْكُمْ أَنْ يَتَقَدَّمَ أَوْ يَتَأَخَّرَ. Those who chose to move backward, they will be confined and they will be jailed, if you will. Rahina, the rahina means it's like hijacked. You know, when you take someone, you hijack someone, or kidnapped. When you kidnap someone, confine someone to a jail, something, that's a, someone being kidnapped and being locked out. So each soul will be locked out. There will be a lock, there will be a circle, there will be a, it becomes like a hostage. Each soul will be considered as a hostage of its own earning. Bima kasabat. And the kasb in the Quran, it has, most of the time, it has been talked about in the sense that someone is earning his sins. بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً in Surah Al-Baqarah, if you go back to the first surah, which supposed to be in the Quran instead of going the, according to Revelation, it says, بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُهُ. Anyone, any soul, any nafs who earns, you earn your سيئة, you earn your bad deed. And the notion here, you earn a bad deed, it shows that you do the bad deed knowing it is wrong or defying the rule of Allah Azza wa Jal. It's not by mistake. It's not that sometimes you make a mistake, like on Ramadan. You make a mistake, you drink water, you don't know, you forgot. It's a mistake. No. But, and that's a mistake. But if you are, if you, I know it's Ramadan and I don't care about fasting and I just go and drink and eat. It is a kasb. It's as if I am earning my food. I am earning my sin. I am earning my khati'ah. So here Allah Azza wa Jal, whenever He uses that in the Quran, al-kasb, it's for bad earning. And when He talks about the good deeds, He says, عَمِلُ الصَّالِحَاتِ. You just do. You perform. And that is, it's a performance. You perform something good. But when you talk about the sins, it's a kasb. And it is something that you earn it so that it becomes on your record. It's in your record and you have to be accountable for. So here Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this notion for the first time in the Quran. كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ. Each soul is going to be a hostage because of what it had earned. It's not because there is a soul that's bad or good. It's not a nafs that is jahili or Muslim nafs. It's not a nafs that's being made internally, genetically prone to doing bad deeds. It is the earning. A soul, a nafs, a person earns his own status. You build your own status. You build your character. You build your trait. You build yourself in a certain manner. And if you build yourself in a negative manner, then you will be hostage to that structure which you built yourself in. So you confine yourself. So you become hostage to that, to the mistakes you make, to the wrong deeds, if you will. بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُهُ in the Quran. فَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ in Surah Al-Baqarah. Those are the owners of Jahannam. They are permanently locked in Jahannam. Here, Allah Azza wa Jalla says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ رَهِينَةً. Each soul, each nafs is going to be tied, tightly coupled. It will be strained or constrained to its own earning. With exception. Now, in general, you would have assumed that, oh, it is everybody is going to be confined to his earning, whether it's good or bad. That's logically. But here Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, no, I'm not going to use the word lacked. You are not lacked to your deeds if your deeds are good. Because your good deeds do not lack you. Your good deeds, they open you up. You are free. The open deeds free you. You become free. And that's a notion of freedom, of real freedom. Not the freedom that capitalists or Democrats talk about, which is the fake freedom, or those are things which, the illusions. This is the real. You are free from the sin. You are free from the most the most biggest event, which Allah Azza wa Jalla called it إحدى الكبر. إنها لإحدى الكبر. One of the greatest things that happen is سقر. And if you are free from سقر, you are free from something big. You are free from something great. So this is the notion that you are hostage, you are locked, and therefore you will be confined to سقر if you earn those bad things. On the other side, إلا أصحاب اليمين. إلا أصحاب اليمين. The ones who are on the right and on the truthfulness side, they will not be hostages. They will not be confined. They will not be locked, which means they will be free. They will be absolutely free. And that's the absolute freedom. The absolute, if you will, liberty. You are absolutely hooked or locked to nothing. Nothing hooks you because you are now under the mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal. You are open. Everyone else who is not within the scope of mercy of Allah Azza wa Jal is locked down, is confined, is hostage. كل نفس بما كسبت رهينة إلا أصحاب اليمين. Except أصحاب اليمين, they are not hostage. The exception here, the way the Quran puts it, the words, كل نفس بما كسبت رهينة, each soul is hostage because of what it had earned, except أصحاب اليمين, the people on the right, who will not be or shall not be hostage of what they have earned. In fact, they will be free because of what they have earned. And the Quran continues now. And this is, again, it's a style of the Quran. Sometimes you find the Quran, the style talks about the people of Jahannam and drags on and talks more and more and more and just brings the people of Jannah with one word. And sometimes he says, those who are confined to hellfire or to Saqar, one word, and then he expands on the people of Jannah. And you will find this very common in the Quran. And this is, it makes it very interesting because it wants to give a glimpse, like one hit. People who earn the bad deeds, they are confined, period. Confined to Jahannam, to Saqar, and forget about them. إِلَّا أَصْحَابَ الْيَمِينَ, and talks more now. أصحاب اليمين, what happens? في جنات يتساءلون. They are in the heavens, in paradises. And they are asking questions. يتساءلون, they are wondering. About whom? They are wondering. في جنات يتساءلون عن المجرمين. They are wondering about the criminals. And here Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this notion, those who oppose Islam, those who stand against Islam, they are criminals. It's not, see, sometimes you say someone who is, he doesn't believe. He doesn't believe, that's fine. He's an oppressive to his own self. He makes oppression to his own self. He's a disbeliever. But if someone does not believe and he wants to suppress the belief, he wants to suppress the belief of others. He does not want this Islam to prevail. He does not want this light to penetrate the darkness. He does not want this rules of Allah Azza wa Jal to take over, then he's a criminal. And here Allah Azza wa Jal is giving this word, it's a right statement, it's a right description. يَتَسَاءَلُونَ عَنِ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. They are asking and wondering about those criminals. What happened to those criminals? What happened to Al-Walid bin Al-Mughira? What happened to Abu Jahl? What happened to Abu Lahab? What happened to Al-Akhnas bin Shuraiq? What happens to Bashar al-Assad? What happens to Abdullah, King of Saudi Arabia or Jordan? What happens to Hosni Mubarak? What happens to these elites of the world? What happens to the presidents and to the rulers? What happened to Fir'aun? What happens to this? Those are criminals. Those are criminals, not because they kill the people. Now, killing is a crime, but the highest level of crime is when you stop the spread of something good for the people. Because to kill someone That is killing one. But to stop the rise of Islam and the rise of good, that's killing nations. That's killing people. That is having millions of people dying of poverty, millions of people dying of diseases, millions of people dying of all types of atrocities. So stopping Islam is the highest level of a crime. So these people, the Muslims now, who are not confined to Jahannam, who are now openly or freely asking questions, they ask now. They are sitting in Jannah, they are enjoying Jannah, and saying, oh, let's see what happened to those guys. What happened to those criminals? What happens to those bad guys? يتساءلون عن المجرمين ما سلككم في سقر. What had led you into سقر? Why did you fall into سقر? And this question, it's not a question that requires an answer or a debate. It is to state a fact. It is, what had brought you into this mess? Sometimes you ask the question to the world here, what is it that got you in this mess, in this financial, economic, social disorder? What is it? And really, you are not expecting from them an answer that describes the issue. You already know the answer. It is, you are requesting a confession of the one who is being sentenced. It's a confession after the fact. It's a confession after the fact means no one can deny it. You know, there is a point, a time where a criminal may deny it. Let's say if you talk to a criminal now, why are you opposing Islam? You say, I'm not opposing Islam, I'm doing you a favor. But now, after once that person or that elite is down and is toppled and is no longer in power, now the time of confession comes in. Now he says, oh, I'm sorry, I should have done this and this. I didn't do that. Or I failed to do this. So the confession after the fact, after the crime has been convicted, after the sentence is gone, there is no room for this denial. So here it is a statement or it's a question to a person who is already in Saqar. مَا سَلَكَكُمْ فِي سَقَرْ. What is it that brought you into Saqar? Then Allah Azza wa Jal wants this confession from the tongues of the kuffar, the criminals, to tell us that those are the issues that lead to Saqar. And there are four things the Quran brings. There are four items. Now, of course, there are more to it. They're under these four items. Those are categories. Number one, they say, قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. Number one, we were not among those who pray. Now, remember, prayer, the word prayer, at the time of Surah Al-Muddathir was revealed, was not the prayer like we know it today. It's not a five times prayer, Fajr, Dhuhr, Asr, Maghrib, Isha. So let's not be confined in this word, لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ, means لَمْ نَكُمْ, we were not among those who worship Allah Azza wa Jal. And the prayer being the highest symbol of prayer. Being the highest symbol of ibadah, of worship. Prayer being the highest symbol of ibadah. So they say, we were not among those who pray. That means we were not worshipping Allah Azza wa Jal. We were worshipping someone else. We were associating with Allah Azza wa Jal some other god. We were worshipping our desires, we were worshipping our constitutions, we were worshipping our laws, we were worshipping our own people, we were worshipping our own will, we were worshipping anything but Allah Azza wa Jal. So we were not praying to Allah Azza wa Jal, we were not bowing to Allah, we were not obeying Allah Azza wa Jal. That's number one. قَالُوا لَمْ نَكُمْ مِنَ الْمُصَلِّينَ. The second one, وَلَمْ نَكُوا نُطْعِمُ الْمِسْكِينَ. We were not among those who feed the poor and the needy. Now, from the very beginning, again, this is, it's very interesting, right? From the very beginning of the revelation of the Quran, it has a special emphasis on this needs of the human. That's the organic, the food need, the drinking, the need, the life, the need for life. Allah Azza wa Jal created people for life. Allah did not create them for suffering. Allah did not create the people to be poor and hungry. Allah created people and created enough resources in the world. And Allah allocated and distributed the resources in his own way. So he gave you more than he gave him. He gave him more than he gave the other person. That's fine. But Allah Azza wa Jal, the fact that he gave you more, he still asked you that out of your money and wealth, you should use your wealth to feed the ones that Allah Azza wa Jal did not give. The fact that Allah Azza wa Jal did not give food to someone does not mean that he wants him to be hungry. But he wants the rich one to feed him. And it's a test for the poor to be patient and tolerate this for Allah Azza wa Jal. And it's a test and an imtihan and a fitna for the rich to give out of this money to the poor. So Allah Azza wa Jal wants this issue of poverty to be resolved right from the very beginning. So when the people declare that one of the reasons they end up in Saqar, in Jahannam, in hellfire, is because of the fact that they did not feed the poor. In another ayah, in Surah رأيت الذي يكذب بالدين قالوا ولم نكن نحض لم نكن من المصلين ولم نكن نحض على طعام المسكين. The same thing, we were not among those who pray or worship Allah Azza wa Jal, and we did not encourage or facilitate, not only encourage, we did not facilitate, we did not make it easy, we did not make it happen so that the poor will get fed. Here we ourselves did not feed the poor. So it's either way, you did not feed the poor if you are rich, or you did not encourage feeding the poor if you are not that rich but you still have an authority. So the second reason, or the second cause of going into Jahannam according to this ayah, number one is the worship in general. The second one is this poverty issue. You are not among those who encourage or facilitate the resolution of poverty and the miskeen and to resolve the issue of the poor. And the third one, وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ. نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ means we play it as it goes. We play it by the rule of the society. We play the rules of the game, if you will. نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ, the way الْخَوْض, it means the way the people swim. You know, you swim, you cross the river, and the way you cross the river based on the current. You see, the current is moving north to south, so you move north to south. So you are not willing to go against the current. If your destination is on the other side of the bank of the river, but the current is going different directions, okay, I'll just go with the current. The current is flowing this way. That's nakhud. The word nakhud, al-khawd, is the way you cross a river, or you cross an ocean, or you cross water. It is something has to do with crossing water. And al-khawd, usually it goes, we are just flowing, we are rowing our boats in the according to the current of the river. That's how we used to go. So don't ask me whether I had to go left or right, north or south, east or west. I used to go based on the wind, how it blows. Meaning that if the people of the society, talking about civil code and civil state, then I will do civil state. الدولة المدنية. If the people in the society, they are talking about democracy, and that's the trend, if the trend is democracy, then I'm for democracy. If the trend is socialism, I will do socialism. And in fact, when I mean it when I say socialism, in the 50s and 60s and partially 70s, socialism was the trend, not capitalism or democracy. Soviet Union was big, was strong, was giving money all over the world, and socialism and socialist parties were the way to go. So some Muslim scholars, even I would quote and quote scholars, writers, they would write books about Islamic socialism. That's the trend. In the beginning of the last century, science and scientific notation was the trend. So we started talking about scientific Quran and scientific Islam. And we tried to explain many of the ayats and the surahs based on scientific notations. For example, when the people start talking about أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ, don't you see how Allah Azza wa Jal treated or dealt with the elephant army of Abraha al-Ashram, and he had some birds coming with the stones from burned or marked with sigil and throwing them at the elephants, they said, ah, you know what? Those birds are nothing but germs or microbes. And they carry disease and viruses and bacteria. They throw them in the elephants and the elephants get killed. That's science. So we don't have to worry about the scientific, about quarreling with the scientist or biologist. So they won't say we are crazy that the birds defeat elephants. So we just say microbes. This is, I'm just giving some examples of the trends. This is how we used to do it. That's a reason to do that. It is one of the reasons, one of the causes that had led those people to Saqar. We looked at it. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is bringing Islam. He's saying Allah azza wa jal is the only God. He's the only Lord. But the trend in Mecca is that idols, you must have an idol. You can't live without idol. You cannot go to Kaaba and just say, I pray to Allah azza wa jal. You must have an idol. Everybody has idol. Everybody worships something, so I better be like that. I'm not going to follow Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad is not the fashion. Muhammad is not the trend, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muhammad is something new. He is the exception. We don't go with the exception. Just like today, you talk about khilafah. Say, oh, khilafah, it's not the trend. It's true. Yeah, they say, it's true. Khilafah is the rule of Islam. That's what Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left after him. That's what Abu Bakr did. That's what Umar, that's what Uthman, that's what Ali. They all did true. We don't argue with that. But you know, brothers, no one is talking about but you. That it's only your fringe group, small party talking about it. The trend, the overall trend is just talk about secular Islamic government. Civil code, you embody Islam with it. That's a trend. That's the fashion. So go with the trend. Don't go with the exception. That is a cause. That's what really led those people. That's what the Quran says. وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ We used to go with the trend. We don't examine the fact as is. We don't look at the facts. We don't scrutinize the fact. We don't analyze it and say, it is a fact. We'll say, this is water, we drink water. But brothers, everybody is drinking pop. Water is not fashion. I'm just going to order Pepsi or Coke. I'm just giving it as an example here. Doesn't mean that drinking Pepsi is wrong. Okay? Just the trend, everybody, you know, in America here, back in the 80s and 70s, the fashion was pop. Everybody's drinking pop. If you drink water, you are odd. It's odd. You must drink Coke, Pepsi, 7-Up, Mountain Dew, whatever. You don't drink water. That's not fashion. That is what I mean by fashion. That's what I mean by trends. And today, politically, and like look at Egypt, what's happening in Egypt, what's happening in Libya and Tunis, the trend is democracy. It's not because democracy is correct. No one has talked about proofs. Whether it's valid or invalid, whether it's correct or incorrect, whether it's true or false. Nobody has looked at this. Whose right is it to rule? Who the sovereignty? Like Jean-Jacques Rousseau, when he was debating the sovereignty. Who has the ultimate sovereignty? He was debating to prove that the ultimate sovereignty lies in the hands of the people. He was trying to prove it. Now, he didn't have the proof. He was trying to prove that the will of the group overrides the will of the individual. That, because that's what democracy is about. It's the will of the people overrides the will of the individual. But that is not... Today, no one even is talking about that. If you start talking about like this, you will say, let's talk about the essence of democracy being the will of the group overriding the will of the individual, so that the will of the group becomes the sovereign and the ruler. They say, no, 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 brother, we don't talk about that. That's not the issue. We'll just talk about this. The nation, the whole nation, have to participate in the execution of the laws and the ruling. And that's how it goes. Everybody is doing that. That's نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ. So this is very serious. It's very serious. Right from the very beginning, Allah Azza wa Jal defined those ground rules. Those are like basics upon which the people must ponder. لم نكن من المصلين. We were not among those who make the salah or the worship to Allah Azza wa Jal. وكنا ولم نكن نطعم المسكين. When it comes to poor and poverty, we have a system that does not deal with poor. We have capitalism. The more you live, the more people, the more money you make, the more poor people will be made as well. That's capitalism. If you look at the trend of capitalism for the last 100 years, we make more money, the world makes more money, which means the economic growth has always been above 0%, which means there is always economic growth. If you look at the level of wealth, today it's in hundreds of trillions of dollars. 100 years ago, it was in hundreds of millions. Hundreds of trillions means it's thousands of times more. But we still have about half of the population of the world poor. More than 50% of the people live under $3 a day, because that's what real poverty. About 1.5 billion people live under $1 a day. But forget the $1 a day. Who lives and who can live on a dollar a day? Not even in Mozambique or Kenya or Ghana. What is $1? Not even in Haiti. $1 a day cannot bring you a can of rice. That is enough to feed one person. So the real poverty today is what this ayah is talking about. وَلَمْ نَكُوا نُطْعِمِ الْمُسْكِينَ. We lived in a lifestyle that leaves people poor behind us. وَكُنَّا نَخُوضُ مَعَ الْخَائِضِينَ. We play the rules of the game as the games, as the rules are being set. We don't make our own rules. We just live with the trend. We go with the trend. We go with the wind. We go with the current of the water. We don't attempt to make any change. We do not want to be part of the exceptions. I don't want to be part of the Khilafah movement because this is exception. It's a fringe. I don't want to call for the rules, the Sharia of Islam. That's an exception. I want to be part of the crowd. And the last one, وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ. And that is the essence. We denied that the day of judgment. وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ. Allah Azza wa Jal left it to the end, to the last. Although it is the most important one. Because the reason you don't feed the poor, because you say, why should I feed the poor? It's my money. But if you knew that you will be accountable for it on the day of judgment, or you will feed, because Allah Azza wa Jal will reward you multiple times for it. If you believe that your day of judgment is coming and you will be accountable for it, then you will not be going with the trend. You will be going with whatever Allah Azza wa Jal says. If you believed on the day of judgment that there will be accountability and you will be accountable, you will not be worshipping anyone but Allah Azza wa Jal. So this is, here Allah Azza wa Jal made at the beginning al-ibadah, and the last one is the belief in the day of judgment. And in between the acts, in between the, and he chose from those acts two major things. One is the poverty and the feeding of the miskin, and the second one is this being part of the trend, the style of living. That's your methodology. What is your method? Your method is, do you go by what is valid, what's invalid, what's correct, what's incorrect, what is right, what's wrong, what's true, what's false? How do you go? Or do you go with, as the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, لا يكن أحدكم إمعة. Don't be إمعة means fluid. In fact, there is a word in mechanics or mechanical engineering called al-mawa'i. Al-mawa'i are things which are fluid, things which are like liquid, juicy type of things, watery. These are imma. Imma means you are fluidish. You just go with the shape of this bottle. You put the water here, it becomes like the bottle. Put it in another can, it becomes like a can. Put it in a bowl, it becomes like, takes the shape of the bowl. That's imma. It says, لا يكون أحدكم إمعة. Don't be an إمعة, the one who takes the shape of the container you are in. إن أصلح الناس أصلحوا. If the people go on the right, being correct, then he becomes correct. وإن فسد الناس فسدوا. And if the people are corrupt, then he's a corrupt. Don't be like this, but be the person of truthfulness. So those are the four issues. The ones, and this is just like the conclusion of the surah, which is really very important. That's the main theme. What is it that lead people to Saqar? Those are four major issues, and they are interdependent. One leads to another. If you deny the day of judgment, accountability. Deny in this case means you deny, you do not perform your acts based on the reasoning that you will be accountable for. Because sometimes you will say, what is the iman? Tell me your arkanul iman. Oh, al-iman billahi wa malaikati wal yawm al-akhir. I believe in Allah and the day of judgment, the angels and on the day of judgment. Also, it's part of your arkanul iman. You believe in them. But let's see, how do you perform your acts? On what basis? Do you perform your acts on the basis that you will be accountable for? Or you perform your acts as if you will never be accountable for? That's what the denial is. The denial of Yawm al-Din is the denial, you know, we all know the state of denial. You know facts, but you do not want to admit them. You do not want to act based on them. You know, like in America here, they know that their financial system is rotten. It's bad. It's wrong. It's incorrectable. It cannot be fixed. But they continue to live and use the same financial system, ignoring the fact that it's going to collapse. That's a state of denial. It's not a state of not knowing. It's a state of denial. So they deny themselves the right to base their acts based on the fact that it will collapse. So, يُكَذِّبُونَ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ وَكُنَّا نُكَذِّبُ بِيَوْمِ الدِّينِ means at the time when we used to do our acts, to perform our deeds, we do not perform our deeds based on the fact that we will be accountable for. So it's not the notion that I believe in the day of judgment. Every Muslim says he believes in the day of judgment. There is no question about that. Because anyone who says not, he's a kafir. Because that's part of the iman. But the point which is made here, it is the basing your acts and your deeds on the fact that there will be an accountability. And this is the relation between what is in this, what you do in this life, to what happens in the life after. There is a relationship. You can't simply live without connecting this life with the hereafter. What's my connection? What's when I perform a deed here, what is the connection between my acts in this life and in the hereafter? It's the accountability. My acts, I am accountable for my acts on the day of judgment. And this accountability is what leads to someone in Saqar or takes someone into Al-Jannah. So here is to summarize this. The people in Jannah, the Muslims, the Mu'mins, they will be wondering, where are these criminals? Oh, here are the criminals. Oh, what brought you into this Saqar? It's as if they are looking at them and asking them the question, what brought you in hell? What made you come to this hell, hellfire? Oh, here is the issue. We did not pray, which means we did not worship Allah Azza wa Jal. We did not feed the poor. We were greedy. We were capitalist. My money is my money. I've earned what I've earned. It's my money. And we used to just live as the people live. We don't care about what's right, what's wrong. If people do something, we just do the way they do. Accidentally, we could be right, or accidentally, we are wrong. It doesn't matter to us. And we did not base our deeds on the day of judgment. We didn't care whether we will be accountable for our acts. That's what we brought us here. So that's why we are in Saqar. حَتَّى أَتَانَ الْيَقِينَ. They say, we did that all our life. حَتَّى أَتَانَ الْيَقِينَ. الْيَقِينَ, in this case, when it's over, there is no return. It's irreversible. You know, sometimes you make mistakes and then you say, oh, this brother still has something good in him. I think he can come back to the right path. But sometimes you'll say, well, this guy has just, he went all the way. He didn't leave any door open. He closed all possible doors. He is locked in. Man, I don't see anything unless Allah Azza wa Jal chooses something else, which is almost towards the end of the life. حَتَّى أَتَانَ الْيَقِينَ. They said, we've done this until death had arrived. Al-yaqeen in this case, in the tafsir it says death. But in reality it's more than that. It is the certainty of this status of saqar. It is locked up. In fact, in Surah Al-Baqarah, again going back, sometimes you go on both ends. The first surah revealed or the fourth surah in the Quran. First surah in the Quran sometimes give those general rules, just like at the beginning of the revelation. This ayah, بَلَا مَنْ كَسَبَ سَيِّئَةً وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُهُ فَأُولَئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Those who have earned their mistakes, their sins, وَأَحَاطَتْ بِهِ خَطِيئَتُهُ, then his خطيئة, his sinful deeds have surrounded him from all over. He blocked all his paths. He closed all the doors. Then those are the owners of hell fire. That is al-yaqeen. That is yaqeen. That is certainty. Certainty of being doomed. You are certain when someone doesn't leave any door open. You know, quite often you talk to a person, you say, you know, I don't have the time to think about it. Okay, maybe sometime he will have time. Or, inshallah, Allah will guide me. You know, sometimes somebody doesn't pray at all, doesn't fast, drinks, have girlfriends. You talk to him, he says, yeah, I know I am doing all of these, but may Allah Azza wa Jal guide me. Allah yahdini. He doesn't want to act now, but he leaves the door open. But sometimes you find someone who drinks alcohol, he says, I don't see any wrong with that. He sells khanzir and pigs. He says, that's just earning. There is no difference between this and anything else. Talks about women, he says, marriage and zina are all the same. Man, this person, he locked all the doors. He doesn't even leave a room for him to maneuver. That's the type of yaqeen here is talking about. When someone is certain of his own acts, he becomes obsessed with his kufr. He is like those leaders, like Gaddafi, before he was killed. He was obsessed with his own garbage. He was obsessed with it. He was obsessed with the fact that he has it all. He is better than God in giving rules to the people. Like Bashar in Syria today. And his elites, they are obsessed with their own kufr. They have become so much determined in the path they are living. So these guys, as far as we are concerned, at this time they have reached that yaqeen. At the moment, this is their yaqeen. حَتَّى أَتَانَا الْيَقِينَ. That's what we do. This is their yaqeen. That's their certainty. Now that certainty can be finalized by death, true. So if somebody dies, then that's it. It's irreversible. Then here Allah Azza wa Jalla says, if somebody acts like this and dies, وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ, and you die at this state, you are going with the civil state, الدولة المدنية, instead of الدولة الإسلامية. You are going with the rules of the people instead of the rules of Allah Azza wa Jalla. You are not worried about the accountability. You say, well, the main thing, we have to satisfy the ambitions of the people locally and internationally, instead of saying satisfying the requirements of Allah Azza wa Jal. If that's what you are and you die, فَمَا تَنْفَعُهُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ, then Allah Azza wa Jal says, what good would that make them? Who's going to save them from the hellfire? Who's going to save you? America, they are pushing you into the civil code. They will come and bail you out. Security Council, NATO, like in Libya, oh, the NATO helped us a lot, so therefore we have to be considered to them. Are they going to bail you out? Who's going to bail you out? We were with the trends of the people. The people, they want us to play democracy. We are Democrats. We will play the games, the rule of the games. Are they going to bail you out? فَمَا تَنْفَعُهُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ. And here Allah Azza wa Jal puts it a word, the Shafi'een, the bailers. Whoever, irrespective, who are they? Because in your brain, at some point, the reason you are doing something, there is someone in the background of your mind. There is something. You are not doing it only with your own skills, only unless you are really just like Fir'aun. Fir'aun, he thinks he is the God. But the ones below Fir'aun, they would think Fir'aun is, can bail them out. So here Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, what type of people who can bail you out? None. فَمَا تَنْفَعُهُمْ شَفَاعَةُ الشَّافِعِينَ. Who can push you or pull you out of this mess? None. فَمَا لَهُمْ عَنِ التَّذْكِرَةِ مُعْرِضِينَ. Then why, if they're really, now with the argument back to them, before they end up in Saqar. Right? Zir Allah Azza wa Jalla is taking you all the way to the future. You are already in Jannah and they are in Saqar and they are the criminals. And you are talking to them. Now, you have seen the argument. Go back to them now. Go back to reality. Why are you not listening? فَمَا لَهُمْ عَنِ التَّذْكِرَةِ مُعْرِضِينَ. Why? كَأَنَّهُمْ حُمُرٌ مُسْتَنْفِرَةٌ. You are just like donkeys. And here, this is for some people to realize and understand. Sometimes you say in, when you are talking about Islam and the kuffar and those who oppose Islam, and then you will say, those guys are idiots. They are ignorants. You give some names, some, you characterize them. Someone will say, oh brother, why are Muslims use the hikmah? You don't say these words. Be careful of what words. What do you mean be careful? Look what the Quran is saying. The Quran is the most careful words ever. Careful means he took care of what words he wants to use. He carefully selected his words. كَأَنَّهُمْ حُمُرٌ مُسْتَنْفِرَةٌ. They are just like donkeys who are dispersed and running away, scared of فَرَّتْ مِنْ قَسْوَرَةٌ. Scared of a lion, being chased by a lion. They are just like donkeys running, being chased by a lion. Look at this description, describing those elites, those kuffar in Quraysh, those Abu al-Walid bin Mughira, Abu Jahl, Abu Lahab, Al-Akhnas bin Shuraiq, those Uqba bin Abi Mu'ayt, Umayyah bin Khalaf, those big elites. Just like today, those big Bashar, Husni, Ali, this, all these garbage ones, Allah is saying, كَأَنَّهُمْ حُمُرٌ. They are like donkeys. And you are telling me, don't use these words, be careful. What? How much careful I can be? How more careful than the Quran? كَأَنَّهُمْ حُمُرٌ مُسْتَنْفِرَةٌ. In another place, Allah Azza wa Jal, He says, the one who has been given the guidance from Allah Azza wa Jal, you give him the guidance, you give him the word, you give him the conviction, you give him the proof. And then he runs away of that. مَثَلُهُ كَمَثَلِ الْكَلْبِ. He's just like a dog. This is the Quran. مثله كمثل الكلب إن تحمل عليه يلهث وإن تتركه يلهث. He is always opening his mouth and his tongue is pulled out and he's out of breath. يلهث means he's out of breath like this always. He's like a dog. That's the Quran. So the Quran right from the very beginning, this is first few ayat revealed. The Quran is just being revealed. This we don't have Al-Baqarah and Al-Nisa and Al-Imran and this is just now. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is alone. Only he has Khadija. Maybe Abu Bakr has been a Muslim or maybe not yet. These are the first few revelations. Allah Azza wa Jalla is saying, look, those people who are given Al-Tadhkira, the reminder, and Al-Quran, and Al-Islam, and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the Deen, those who are given this as Al-Tadhkira, and they are turning their back. معرضين عن التذكرة. معرض means you look aside. You don't even want to pay attention. You don't even want to look at the essence of Islam. We're telling you now, especially these days, look, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed Al-Quran. Allah revealed Islam. Islam is for ruling. Islam for the life. Islam for economy. Islam for social life. Islam for political life. Islam for the life of the people. This is what it should be happening in this, those called the Arab Springs. You toppled a regime, you toppled one dictator, don't bring another stupid thing. Bring Islam back. This is what it is. Then they look aside and say, no, not now. Not now, not now. We don't want to look at it. We like it, we believe in it, but not now. Turning aside, when you turn aside from Islam, when you look to the different direction, when you do not look at it, mu'arid doesn't even mean that you abandoned it. It's just you are not considering it. At this time, I'm not considering that. That because that's what we hear. We believe in it. We like it.
but we are not considering it right now. That's mu'rid. When you say mu'rid, mu'rid, I just look aside. I'm not scrutinizing what you are offering me. What's being put on the table? Let's say if you put Islam for discussion on the table, I say, no, 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 leave it aside. Not now. Let me look at the constitution made by the people for all parties, for all groups of the of this life. That's mu'aridin. فَمَا لَهُمْ عَنِ التَّذْكِرَةِ مُعْرِضِينَ. And then the Quran says, they are just like donkeys who are running away from a qaswara. Qaswara is means a lion. Just, and the notion here, it's almost as if this Islam is powerful. This Islam is powerful. It's not weak. Although it's now it's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam alone, but it is like a lion. It's like a lion. And those who are looking aside, they are like the donkeys. كأنهم حمر مستنفرة فرت من قسورة. There are only a few ayat. I know we took too long, but let me finish it so that we don't come to the surah again, because there are only three more ayat. Bear with me. Now, the Quran doesn't leave anything without answers. Because sometimes you'll say, what is it that goes inside these people? What's really wrong? You know, if here is the tadhkira, some reminder, some good stuff. It's like the moon. It's like the end of the night. It's like the day. And it's Islam. And it's the Quran. And if you read just these surahs, the way it sounds, the way it rhymes, the surah in itself, it provides this decisive thing that this cannot be from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those ayat must be from Allah azza wa jal. This is not someone like anyone from the Arab people who can talk like this. Ya ayyuha al-muddathir qum fa'andhir wa rabbaka fa'kabbir wa thiyabaka fa'tahhir. The Arabs have been talking poetry for all their lives, but they never wrote something like this. So it must be clear it's from Allah azza wa jal. Then what's wrong? Sometimes you start wondering, what is it that goes inside the hearts and the souls and the minds of people like Al-Walid, like Abu Jahl, sometimes you start wondering, like Bashar, or like Qaddafi at the time, or Husni Mubarak, or those kings, what goes in their minds? Why don't they just submit to the fact that let's surrender to the rules of Allah Azza wa Jal? Whether we are in the ruling or anyone else, let's bring Islam. What goes in their brains? What goes in their emotions? Here, says, بَلْ يُرِيدُ كُلُّ مُرْءٍ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُؤْتَى صُحُفًا مُنَشَّرَةً. Each one of them, those elites, he wants to be the one who is in charge. He wants to be the one who is subject to the revelation. Now, when it comes to Islam, they think, oh, why is it Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam should be the prophet? I could have been a prophet myself. لَوْلَا أُنزِلَ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِّنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. In another ayah, they said, oh, only if this Quran was revealed to one of those great people in Mecca or al-Ta'if, like al-Walid bin al-Mughira in Mecca or Abd Yalayl in al-Ta'if. Only if we received the Quran instead of him, then it would have been a different story. Now, why they want the Quran? It's not because they believe in the Quran or they want to believe in it. They just want to be in charge. They want to sustain this authority, to sustain this power. They want to sustain this ability to rule the people or to be on top of the people. They think that this Quran is nothing but a matter of ruling. They think it's a matter of authority. They don't think it is a matter of devotion to Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a matter of taqwa. It's a matter of iman. It's a matter of belief. It's a matter of being attached to Allah Azza wa Jal. They don't think of it this way. They think it's a prestige. It is something, wow, oh, Muhammad now is claiming he's a prophet. Man, that's great. How could we be like him? Abu Jahl, when he was asked about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by his colleagues, would you ever believe in Muhammad? He said, no way. This man is from Quraysh, from Bani Hashim, and I'm from Bani Makhzum. How could we? How could I? I want to be just like him. بَلْ يُرِيدُ كُلُّ مْرِئٍ مِّنْهُمْ أَن يُؤْتَى صُحَفًا مُنَشَّرًا. Each one of them, he wants his own book. So Allah Azza wa Jal, وَاللَّهُ يَخْتَصُّ بِرَحْمَتِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. They forget that it's Allah's choice. Allah is the one who chooses for his rahmah, whomever he wishes. كَلَّا going back to يوم الدين. كلا indeed بل لا يخافون الآخرة. In reality they are not afraid of الآخرة. They don't believe in الآخرة. They don't want to think about الآخرة, the day of judgment or the second life. لا يخافون الآخرة. In reality that's what their problem is. So on one issue they are jealous of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. They want it for themselves. They don't want this deen to be in the hand of a person other than them. That's one thing. The other thing is they don't really care about al-akhirah. They think about this dunya only, this current life, this day only. They are not even thinking of tomorrow. Leave alone the day after. After death. كَلَّا بَلْ لَا يَخَافُونَ الْآخِرَةِ كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكَرَةِ. Now turning back to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم and to us, don't worry about it. It is only a reminder. It's only an alert. That's what our duty is. You bring this as a ticket, as a reminding ticket. It's a reminding story to the people. We don't force this upon anyone. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكِرَةِ فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَةِ. Whoever wants to use it as a reminder, let them use it. We are not going to push it on any people. And that's what they argue about us. Oh, you want to force Islam upon people. We don't want to force Islam upon people. We don't force ideas upon people. A system can be forced, but not ideas. Now, a system can be forced. It's not only Islam. Everybody in the world has forced his own system. There is no ruling whatsoever has ever ruled by the total conviction of people. That's not true. How many times have we heard the word from the US that we are fighting a war for democracy? What does this mean? We are fighting a war to enforce democracy as a system. Now, they cannot force ideas upon people, but they force systems. You fight Nicaragua, you fight Panama, you fight Afghanistan, you fight Pakistan, you fight Iraq, you fight many places. The Soviet Union fought many wars to enforce socialism as a system. Systems can be forced, and they have always been forced. But ideas, not. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكَرَ فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَ. Islam and the Muslims from the very first days have realized this fact. It is only a ticket of reminder. It is only this type of idea to remind the people with and to give it to people as alert, as an alarm. Whoever wants to believe in it, فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَ فَمَنْ شَاءَ. Whoever wants to use it, God bless you. وَمَا يَذْكُرُونَ إِلَّا أَنْ يَشَاءَ اللَّهِ. And it's all with the will of Allah Azza wa Jal. Allah Azza wa Jal wishes that the people would use it, they will. It will not be enforced upon one, upon anyone. Allah هو أهل التقوى وأهل المغفرة. That's the last statement by giving us a notion, one notion about Allah Azza wa Jal. You know about this صفات, characteristics, names. Who is Allah Azza wa Jal? We still, right at the beginning, we don't even know. Just God the Creator. He designates Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What else? So he has a day of judgment. He has Saqar. He has some stuff. And then he adds one more thing. Allah هو أهل التقوى. أهل التقوى mean he deserves to be not I don't want to use the word fear, but اتقاء, avoid. He deserves to be avoided. أهل التقوى, he deserves to be. أهل means he is capable of being avoided, or he is powerful enough, big enough, strong enough, deserve to be avoided. Yeah, he deserves that. He, because of him, he has enough properties and characteristics of his own that he deserves to be avoided. You better avoid him. وهو أهل المغفرة. And he has enough characteristic and property to provide مغفرة. So on one hand, you better watch for him. And on the other hand, he can forgive whenever he wants. So he can forgive. He has all the capacity to forgive. And he has all the capacity that you should fear him and you should avoid him. So on one hand, from one side, you better be careful. And from the other side, remember that Allah Azza wa Jal can forgive. That's the final and the end of the surah. May Allah Azza wa Jal enable us to benefit from it. I know we took too long for this session. It's about 1 hour, 25 minutes and 24 seconds. According to my to my clock here. Jazakumullah khair. I will just open this for anyone who has comment or still awake to make for the sisters. If sisters have any questions, we will not take any of your questions. This is our no, I'm just kidding. If you have questions, please send them down somehow with any of the we just sent a young man to bring questions if you have any. And any of the brothers have any comment or question, please go ahead. Yes. Because fear is the question is, why don't we use the word fear, the word fear for taqwa? Fear is translated into khashya. There is the word, the Quran used the word yakhsha, innama yakhsha Allah min ibadihi al-ulama, that's fear. Use the word min khashyatih, the fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. Fear is translated into khashya. At-taqwa is a derivative of the word waqa. Ittaqa. Ittaqa means avoid. You be careful so that you don't fall in a ditch. That's called ittaqa. Ittaqa al-marad. As they say, al-dirham wiqaya. Wiqaya khayru min qantari ilaj. To avoid being sick, spend one dirham, one, let's say, dollar, in avoiding being sick, better than spending 1,000 for cure. So the word wiqaya, taqwa, is a derivative of this avoidance. So you better avoid the wrath of Allah Azza wa Jal, the anger of Allah. Protect yourself from the anger of Allah Azza wa Jal. Avoid being in a spot where Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't like you. Now, when you do this frequently or more often, then you accumulate or you build this character of taqwa. So this avoidance and the protection becomes a characteristic. So taqwa, you continuously always looking and watching, so Allah Azza wa Jal does not catch you in a position where He is angry with you. So that's why I prefer the word for taqwa, avoidance and protection and deterrence rather than fear. Yes, go ahead. Yes, there are two things here. It's the language and the meanings with values. The language is a barrier, although Arabs understand Arabic and the Quran is in Arabic, but the Arabic language, the power of the language deteriorated over the last 100 years, purposely, of course. On purpose, they did not teach the culture of Arabic language in a manner that people understand the Quran for the purpose of not understanding the Quran. That's number one. Number two, the values. The values, you get them out of the Quran when you ponder on them. And that's what we try to do in this tafsir. It's not like when you say, حمر مستنفرة. It's easy to understand for anyone who understands Arabic, oh, this is talking about donkeys that run away. But to visualize the value here is that anyone who puts himself in the shoes of Abu Lahab or Abu Jahl or Al-Walid bin Mughira is no more than a donkey. So that's a value. Now, to get the value, it needs thinking. So we need some people like us, like these sessions, when we start, we put it in perspective. So I'm not just saying that, oh, those who turn their faces away from Quran and Islam, they are like humurun mustanfira, like donkeys who run away from a lion. But then we say, this ayah, although it talked about the kuffar of Quraysh, but it applies to the kuffar at each and every period of time. It applies to anyone who refrains from accepting the words of Islam as a final word. They are just like that. That's true. That's why the Islam has not been progressed in the last 100 years, because people have been following the trend and the culture and the fashion and not Islam. And that's why we are here. That's what we are talking about. We want to revive this issue. We want to build this community of people who understand that Islam is the culture as it was revealed. And the title here of our tafsir is Quran as Revealed. Just as revealed. Look at from the very beginning, how it was revealed, right from the very first days. If you think and you arrive at the truth and you leave the truth because of the general culture, that is wrong. Right from the very beginning. So we want to build this and we want to make it as the trend. And this is how Islam started. Yes, in Syria, in Libya, in Egypt, in Iraq, in Iran, in Turkey, all over, they left. Islam has become just a rhetoric. It's not a culture. It's not the driving force. And that's what we have to mend and correct. Same thing, yeah. So you arrived at the conclusion that those countries, they do not qualify to be Islamic states. They are states in which Muslims live, but they don't live Islam. Good. Yes, go ahead. إِلَّا كَافَّةَ لِلنَّاسِ بَشِيرًا وَنَذِيرًا. Saqar is, just take it now for now, I'll go back from this. The question is, the word Saqar, what does it mean or why do we use it? And then the notion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam being a mubashir wa nadhir, or nadhiran wa bashira. As far as Saqar is a name, just like for Jahannam, Al-Qari'a is a name for Jahannam, Jahannam is a name for Jahannam, Saqar is a name for Jahannam. And there are other names also, which I cannot recall right now. In the Quran, they have been used for Jahannam. As-Sahira also, one of the names that was used. But also, it's Saqar is a derivative of a word that is abrasive heat, which is intolerable heat. That's when you say this in Arabic poetry. They used to use tasqir nar. When someone is making wood fire, you make it absolutely cold. When it becomes like the charcoal becomes absolutely red, they say this is tasqir. So when the fire or the wood becomes so red and no longer smoke is coming from that, that is the notion of saqar. So saqar is the just fire, absolutely. So it's no longer a wood. You know, when you say wood, once you burn it, you come at some point, you cannot recognize it as a wood. It's just big fire. So that's saqar. Now the bashir wa nadhir, because the word nadhir, as I said, it's an alert. It's a triggering of an alarm. And usually the alarm is when something, you have to avoid something bad. Okay, when you say you trigger an alarm, like the fire alarm, or when the car alarm goes off, or when the sirens of war, they go on. That means something disastrous or catastrophic would happen, so you better be careful. So al-inzar or al-nadhir or this alarm is always tied up to something negative, something that will happen. You better be careful. Just get out from where you are. Otherwise, you will be killed. Otherwise, you will be destroyed. Just take shelter, take refuge, take something, do something. That's inzar. Al-bashir, whenever I want to, it's a warning, it's an alert, but it's not warning. It's an expectation. Just like when I say, now we are here in this masjid, someone will come in from the door in a few minutes, he's bringing all types of food and the fruits and something nice, something goodies. So I'm making tabshir. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made this both, because he alerts for the Jahannam, for disastrous, catastrophic event of Jahannam. And at the meantime, he gives the expectation of Al-Jannah. So that's Bishara. Now, for anyone who will, and it's both for believers. Al-Bishara, Bashir wa Nadhir, because the one who takes note of the Indar, or a warning, and the one who takes note of the bishara and the glad tiding is the one who believes in him. Right? Because if you don't believe, you simply say, oh, that's a wrong siren. You know, sometimes the fire alarm goes off, says, oh, everybody just stay, don't leave. You say it's false alarm, so you don't go. But then the fire comes up and it burns everybody. So if you don't believe that it was a real alarm, you will be burned by it. So the alarm is for those who believe in it as well. Okay. Was that the question? Okay. Tea time? Okay. Yeah, it's we'll take a break for refreshments, for tea. And then we'll... it's downstairs, then we'll come for prayer, inshallah. Come back for prayer. Assalamu alaikum.